Hi guys, in this question we are providing all the solutions of ISRO papers, and this is the ISRO 2017 examination CS paper. And the question is, if A is a skew symmetric matrix, then A transpose will be. Okay, so first, for this question, first we should know what is the A transpose. A transpose means, if we have one given matrix like this, A equals to 1, 0, 2, any elements can come here, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9. This is the given matrix. Okay, since this is the 3 cross 3 matrix. So A transpose means we are interchanging all its row into the column. Okay, so in the A transpose matrix, this first row will become the first column of this matrix. So 1, 0, 2, then the second row 3, 4, 5 will become the second column of this matrix. 3, 4, 5. And the third row 7, 8, 9 will become the third column here. This matrix is called the transpose matrix of this given matrix A. Okay, so for matrix being called symmetric or skew symmetrics, there will be one condition it should have to follow. For example, for skew symmetric, the condition is A equals to minus of A transpose. Okay, this is the condition for skew symmetric matrix. And if A equals to A transpose, then it is called the symmetric matrix. Okay, so in this question we have to find a skew symmetric matrix, then A transpose will be minus A for the skew symmetric matrix. Okay, so right answer here is option D, minus A. In this question, let A and B be any two arbitrary events, then which one of the following is true? So first, I am considering here option number 1, which is given PA intersection B equals to PA into PB. This statement is true only if events are independent. Okay, so what are the independent events? If there are two events, and if for example, if we are tossing two coins one after another, so the result of the first coin will not affect the result of the second coin. Okay, so this is called the independent event. So whenever the independent events are occurring, if these two are the independent events, then PA intersection B will be PA into PB. Okay, so this is not true for all the arbitrary events, so this statement is false. The second one is PA union B equals to PA plus PB. So we know the general formula for PA union B, means either A occurs or B occurs, equals to PA, means A is occurring, or PB, B is occurring, minus PA intersection B, means both are occurring together. Okay, so this statement, PA union B equals to PA plus PB, it will be true for the mutual exclusive events. If A and B are the mutually exclusive events, then only this statement is valid, because in the mutually exclusive events, PA intersection B equals to phi, means it will become null. And what are the mutually exclusive events? So in this probability theory, two mutually events are like this. If both events cannot occur together, for example, if we are flipping one coin, then in one flipping, either head will occur, or head will occur on the top, or the tail will occur on the top. So these two are the mutually exclusive, means both events cannot occur together. So this is called the mutually exclusive events. So for the mutually exclusive events, this PA intersection B, this means both cannot together, or both cannot occur together, so this will become phi, then only this PA union B equals to PA plus PB will be valid. So this is also not the right answer for the two arbitrary events. This is true only for the mutually exclusive events. So this is not our answer. The third one is PA occurring, or probability of happening A event after occurring or after happening the B. Okay, this is the general formula, or this is the general term it will represent. So in this statement, it is saying PA divided by B, or PA by B, means after occurring the B, probability of occurring A will equals to PA intersection B into PB. This is completely wrong because we know PA by B, it means probability of occurring of A after the occurring of B. So it is equals to PA intersection B divided by P of probability of occurring B. So actual right statement here will be PA intersection B equals to PA by B into PB. So this statement is completely wrong for any event, okay? And in the last, PA union B less than equals to PA plus PB, okay? So this statement is true for all the arbitrary events because we know that PA intersection B, this, the maximum value of this PA intersection B, it is greater, it is actually greater than or equals to zero. It means intersection PA intersection will be, A intersection B will be greater than equals to zero. So in the general formula PA union B, if I am putting this value PA plus PB minus PA intersection B, okay, and we know the minimum value, or we know the minimum or at least value of PA union B is greater than equals to zero, okay. So if this is zero, then PA union B will be PA plus PB. And if this is some something like 0.1 or 0.2, something like, okay, for these values, this PA plus PB minus something positive, so this PA union B will always be less than or equals to this PA plus PB, this term, okay. So our final answer will be, for any two arbitrary events, this PA union B less than equals to PA plus PB, this will be valid for all the arbitrary events. So this is our right answer. In this question, using Newton-Raphson method, a root correct to 3 decimal places of x cube minus 3x minus 5 equals to. So in this question, we have given one function fx equals to x cube minus 3x minus 5, and we have to find the root using the Newton-Raphson method correct to 3 decimal places, okay. So we know the formula of the Newton-Raphson method. Anyway, we can derive this formula using the Newton-Raphson method. But now in this question, I am using this formula xn plus 1 equals to xn minus f of xn divided by f dash of xn. This is the first derivative of the given function f, okay. Now to start the iteration, or to we have to start this method by assuming one value of x, at which this function will be more closer to the x, okay. So if I put the value 3 in this function, okay, so it will give f of 3 equals to 3 to the power 3, 27 minus 3 into 3, which is 9, minus 5, it will give the value 13 here, okay. So f3 is 13, which is closer to 0, okay. So now our x0 will be 3. We can assume the value of x by these given options, okay. So at the value 3, it is given 13, which is closer to 0, okay. So now I can assume x0 equals to 3, so our x0 will be 3 here. Now I have to find the f dash x, okay. So f dash x equals to, first derivative of this function will be 3 into x square minus 3, okay. This is first derivative, and according to the formula we have to find the x1, okay. So first root, this is the x0 is also assumed root, and we can get more roots in the more closer value, okay, in the respective or in the successive iteration. So x1 equals to x0 minus f of x0 divided by f dash of x0, okay. So then in this, if I am putting the f dash 3, it will give 24, okay. So now our x1 in the first iteration first iteration x1 will be x0 which is 3 minus f of x0 which is 13 f of 3 and divided by f dash of 3 which is 24. So it will give the value something like 2.97937. okay, this value it will give. And we have to perform next iteration, which is x2 equals to x1 minus f of x1 divided by f dash of x1. Okay, so in this again we have to put this 2.97 in this function fx. It will give some value. And f dash x, again we have to put this value of x1 in the f dash x function, so it will give some value. And then we will find the x2. Okay, so we have to perform, or we have to repeat these steps until we got two consecutive x same. Okay, until we got the two consecutive value of x will be same. Okay, till then we have to perform the iteration. And after applying these same thing in fourth iteration, we got value 2.279. you can apply all this value. Okay, here. So after fourth iteration we'll get this value, and fifth iteration we'll get the same value 2.279. okay, so this will be our answer after fifth iteration. So this is the answer, C, 2.279 is the correct answer. In this question, what does a data dictionary will identify? Okay, so there is one concept called data dictionary which is used in the database systems. Okay, so these dictionary will identify. Okay, so what is the data dictionary contains? Okay, so if we know that in the data dictionary terms, data dictionary will contain the field name of the object or anything file which we are storing in the data dictionary or the data. So field name will be there, field format is also there in the data dictionary, and field types, okay, this is also in the data dictionary. So all of the above will be answer here. In this question, which of the following concurrency control protocol ensures both conflict serializable actually here and free from deadlock? Okay, so in the timestamp ordering protocol and in the two phase locking protocol, both ensures the conflict serializability. Okay, so conflict serializability is ensured by both timestamp ordering and two phase locking protocol. But this deadlock, free from deadlock, this is not the deadlock may occur in the two phase locking protocol, but deadlock will never occur in the timestamp ordering protocol. So timestamp ordering is the correct answer here. And we can see here why two phase locking protocol, the deadlock may occur in two phase locking protocol. So what is the case when this deadlock can occur? So if there are two transactions, let's suppose T1 is one transaction, T2 is the another transaction, and in T1, if there are two data items or data members, variables A and B are there, okay, or these two can be these two A and B can be resource also. Okay, so now if this T1, in the T1 transaction, first this T1 is locking, or T1 want to use this A, so it will lock in the growing phase or in the locking phase, it will lock this A on the exclusive lock. This T1 is locking exclusive lock on A, okay, and then this T2 will lock the exclusive lock on B because it wants to use B first. Now in the locking phase or first phase of the two phase locking protocol, if this T1 has already locked the exclusive lock on A, and if he it wants to use B also, B resource also, so it will try to lock B here, but B is already locked by T2, and T2 wants to use A resource also, so it will lock XA here in the growing phase or in the first phase of two phase locking protocol. Now we can see that T1 has already locked the A resource A, and it wants to use, and it wants to lock again the B resource, okay, but this B is already locked by T2, and T2 wants to use A, which is already locked by T1. So no transaction will commit here or no transaction will proceed, and both will be stuck in deadlock in the growing phase only. Okay, so this is called the deadlock scenario in the two-phase locking protocol. So two-phase locking protocol does not ensure free from deadlock. So our answer is timestamp ordering here. In this question, we have given one table or one relation, and in the relation there are three attributes: employee, department and OT allowance. Okay, so this is the table given. We have to answer the following SQL query: select count star from select employee department. This is the query given. Okay, so we know that first this query will run because this is the internal query. Okay, so in this query there are two sub queries: select employee department from overtime allowance. Okay, so the relation is having the name overtime allowance, which is given here. Now we have to select employee comma department. Okay, so this is the resulting table, because in this table we have to select employee department from this table. So Rama and mechanical, Gopi electrical, this table will select. Okay, selected. Now the second sub query is select department comma OT allowance from overtime allowance. So from this table we have to again select department and OT allowance. Okay, so in this table or in this relation, department and OT allowance is also selected. So for example, this mechanical OT allowance 5000, electrical 2000, this computer 4000, civil 1500. Okay, so now these are the two tables. This is and this is ST. Okay, so this table, let's suppose now in this question this query will wants to natural join of these two relation. Okay, so we know that then in the natural join we don't need to provide any join condition, because system will already join the two tables on the basis of the common name attribute. So here in these two tables, this department is the common attribute, because this department is present in both the relation. So now the system will join naturally. Okay, so that's why it is called natural join. So it will join on the basis of department, and whenever the departments of those both the two is having same value, it will join the two relations. Okay, so the resultant table after joining is having the name as T. Okay, because here it is giving T, and in the resultant table this column employee will be present, this department, because this department is common in both the relation, so department will present only one time here, and this OT allowance. Okay, so I have three column here, 1, 2 and this three column, and the first column is employee, the second column or second attribute will be the department, which is the join condition of on the basis of department we will have to perform the join. So this department, and the third is OTA, OT allowance. Okay, overtime allowance. Now whenever those tuples which is having the same this value, same department value, it will select it in the resultant join table. So we can see that this Rama and mechanical, this tuple and in this tuple both department is same, which is mechanical. So we can select this tuple. We should select this tuple complete, Rama mechanical 5000. So I'm putting here R, which means Rama, department is mechanical, and the overtime allowance is 5000. The next tuple will be Gopi, and this electrical and this electrical is same. Okay, so it will join this also, electrical, and the value of 2000. The third one is Sindhu, computer, I'm putting CO here, and 4000. And the next one is Mahesh, civil, which is I'm putting CI, and here 1500. Okay, so this will be the resultant table. And now now in the outer query it wants to count star. Okay, so this query wants to select the number of rows present in this resultant table, because count star is the aggregate function which is used to count the number of tuples in the resultant table or in any table. Okay, so this count star will count the number of tuples here. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 tuples will be selected. final answer will be 4, because it is it wants only count star. Okay, so it wants only the number of tuples present in this resulting table. So this will be our answer 4. In this question, we have to identify which symbol denote derived attributes in ER model. Okay, so in the ER model, which of the following symbol represent the derived attribute? So for this, we should know about what is the derived attributes. So derived attributes are basically those attributes for which we don't need to provide any value explicitly. Okay, the system will internally or implicitly know its value from some other attributes. For example, from some other attributes, and these attributes which are from which we are getting the value of this derived attribute, those attributes are called the stored attributes, and these attributes are called the derived attributes. For example, here we can take one example. If there is one database relation of having name student, okay, so student is one entity. Okay, so I am talking about here ER model. So I am taking this student entity. Okay, so basically this is a student entity. Now in this student entity, we can have some attributes of this student entity. For example, name, address, or branch of the student, which branch or which class he is currently studying here. Okay, and there is one stored attribute, which is date of birth of that student. Okay, that student entity. So here I am calling DOB as a stored entity, and we can have one derived attribute. So derived attribute, we can represent the derived attributes in the ER relationship model with this dashed ellipse. Okay, so this dashed ellipse is representing here the derived attribute of age. Okay, so let's suppose age is one derived attribute. So why it is calling the derived attribute? Because we don't need to provide the value of this age explicitly for each student. Okay, we have to provide the date of birth value of each student entity, and we can know the age of that student with the help of this stored attribute. Okay, so this is called the stored attribute, and this is, since this value of this attribute is deriving from this DOB, so this is called the derived attribute. And derived attribute is represented in the ER model by the dashed ellipse. So our final answer is this. In this question, the symmetric difference of sets A equals to this and B equals to this is. So in this question, we have given two sets, which is A and B, and we have to find the symmetric difference between those sets. Okay, so what is the symmetric difference? Symmetric difference, we can represent the symmetric difference of two sets with this picture. Okay, so if this is set A and this is set B, then symmetric difference is this part. Okay, so this part and union this part. Okay, so these two parts combinedly is called the symmetric difference. So we can write this form in numerically like this in set theory. A symmetric difference B equals to, we can represent symmetric difference by this also. Okay, so this equals to A minus B, means set, this is set difference operation, A minus B union B minus A. Okay, so for this we have to find first A minus B. A is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 and 8. This is A minus B. B is 1 1 3 5 6 7 8 9. So we have to subtract this set from this set. Okay, so all the elements which are present in this set, and they, if they are also present in this A set, then we have to subtract those elements from this set A. For example, this 1, okay, since 1 is present in set B also and A also, so we are subtracting this 1 from here. So 1 is crossed. Now 2 is not present here. 3 is present, so 3 is crossed. 5 is present, so 5 is crossed, 6 is present, 6 is crossed, then 7 and 8 are also present here, so we crossed here. Okay, so only 2 comma 4 are left in the operation A minus B. Okay, now similarly we have to find B minus A, and in B minus A we have to subtract this set from this set. Okay, so those are the elements which are present in this set, and okay, and those which are also present in this set we have to subtract from here. Okay, for example, 1 is present here and 1 is present here, so I am crossing 1 here. 2 is not present here. Okay, 3 is present in this set and it is also present in this set, so I am subtracting here. Okay, you can confuse here, so I am showing this separately here. This is B set 1, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This is set B minus set 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, this is set A. So we have to subtract this complete set from this set. So since 1 is present here, so I am crossing here 1. 3 is also, 2 is not present here. 3 is present here. So it's not, 3 is, will remain here, but 3 is crossed from here. Then 4 is not present here. 5 is present. Okay, so I am crossing here. 6 is present, crossing here. 7 is already present. 8 is also present here. So only 9, this element only left in B minus A. So B minus A will be 9. Now for symmetric difference, we have to take union of these two sets, 2, 4 and 9, A minus B and B minus A. Okay, when I do union of these two sets, it will give 2, 2, 4, 9. So our final answer will be 2, 4, 9. This is the right answer. In this question, we have to tell which statements are true here. Okay, so the statements are: S1, every context sensitive language L is recursive, and there exists a recursive language that is not context sensitive. Okay, so we can answer this question by Chomsky hierarchy of the language. Okay, in the Chomsky representation or Chomsky hierarchy of the languages, there are 4 types of languages, and we can see here. First is regular language. Okay, this regular language, then CFL or context free languages, and then CSL, context sensitive language, and the last after this there is recursive language. Okay, and recursive enumerable, okay, which is called unrestricted grammar. Okay, so in this question, every context sensitive language L is recursive. This statement is true because this CSL is a set which is a proper subset of this recursive, okay, recursive language set. Okay, so every context sensitive language is also a recursive language, and there exists a recursive language that is not context sensitive. Yes, since this recursive set is a superset of this context sensitive languages, so there will be some languages which are in context in this recursive languages set, but these languages are not in the context sensitive language set. Okay, so both statements are here correct. So answer is this, D. In this question, which one of the following is false? Okay, so in this question we have to identify which of the statements here is given false. There is a unique minimal DFA for every regular language. So this statement is true because we can construct minimal DFA for any regular language we have given. Okay, so this is true statement. Every NFA can be converted to an equivalent PDA. This statement is also true because we can convert every NFA, okay, to an equivalent PDA. Okay, but yeah, reverse is not true. Every PDA, we cannot convert every PDA into the NFA. So this statement is true, but converse of this statement is not true. Complement of every context free language is recursive. So we already know that since context free languages are not closed under the complementation, so there are some languages it is already found that there are some context free languages, and complement of those context free language is context sensitive language, which is actually recursive language. Okay, so we can say that complement of every context free language is recursive. This statement is true. Every non-deterministic PDA, okay, NDP and NPDA, non-deterministic PDA, can be converted to an equivalent DPDA, deterministic PDA. Okay, so this is not true, because both machines are having the different power. It means the DPDA or deterministic pushdown automata is a subset of non-deterministic pushdown automata. Means there are some languages which is accepted only by the non-deterministic pushdown automata, but it is not accepted by the deterministic pushdown automata. It means we cannot construct the DPDA for those languages which are accepted by the NPDA, non-deterministic pushdown automata. Okay, so since these two machines they do not have the equal power, so every non-deterministic PDA cannot be converted to an equivalent deterministic PDA. So this statement is false. Okay, so answer is this D. In this question, in some programming language, an identifier is permitted to be a letter followed by any number of letters. Okay, followed by any number of letters or digits. So you should pay attention to this line. What saying? If L and D denote the sets of letters and digits respectively. So L is basically the letters. Okay, it will be anything A, B, C, something like. Okay, so this is one set, and D denotes the sets of digits like 0, 1, 2, 3, like dash. Okay, which of the following expression defines an identifier? So we have to define identifier, and for identifier they have given one rule. An identifier is permitted to be a letter followed by any number of letters or digits. Okay, so in the identifier, first one will be a letter, because it is saying here, and after that, because the letter followed by any number of letters or digits. Okay, so after this letter, any number of letters or digits can be come. So this is one letter, or means I am putting here plus sign, plus means or, letter or digit, this is D. And since these can come any number of times after this L, after this one L which is compulsory, so I am putting here star. Star means zero or more number of times. Okay, so since zero or more number of times means any number of time it L or D, letter or digit can come. So this is our the final answer, L, L plus D star. In this question, the recurrence relation that arises in relation with the complexity of binary search is. Okay, so in this question they are asking, we have to apply binary search, and binary search follow one recursive relation. Okay, so which of the following is recursive relation that is applied or that will be come into binary search. Okay, so we know the binary search operation. If this is one given array, which is for binary search, this array should be sorted. Okay, so array should be sorted. So since this array is sorted, and there are some numbers like here, and this is the indexing 0, 1, 2, so on, n minus 1. So let's suppose there are n numbers into this array. Okay, now if we have to find this x, element x in this array, so first what will binary search do? It will find the middle element. Okay, so middle will be the lower index plus higher index divided by 2. So first it will find the middle element, and then it will compare this x element with the middle element. Okay, let's suppose this is n by 2th element or the middle element, this is m. Okay, now if this x and this m is same, if this x is equals to this m, it means we have searched the desired x. Okay, so it will directly return. Okay, and no recursive call will be generated. But if this x is less than m, this middle element a of m, if the array name is a, then a of m, if this x element is less than this element, then we have to search this x only in this part of array. It means we divide the main problem into only its half problem. Okay, now this x has to search on this array only. Okay, because it is already sorted, since m, this middle element a of m, which is greater than the desired element x. Okay, so now if this x is less than the middle element, then definitely if this x is present in the array, it will definitely into the left hand side of the array or left hand side of this middle element. Okay, so our desired problem will be t of n. Let's suppose t of n, then in the first recursion call or first recurrence, it will get into half t n by 2. Okay, t n by 2. So we have to now search only this part, t n by 2 plus some constant amount of time. Why constant? Because we are just finding the middle element, mid equals to 0, high plus low by 2, and then only one comparison with this required element or desired element x. Okay, so comparison and this two operation takes the constant time. So this will be our recurrence formula or recurrence relation regarding the binary search. Okay, so final answer is tn equals to tn by 2 plus k, k is a constant. In this question, which one of the following in place sorting algorithms needs the minimum number of swaps? So in this question we have given some in place sorting algorithms like insertion sort, quick sort, heap sort and selection sort, and we have to identify which of the following algorithm takes the minimum number of swaps. So minimum number of swaps is swaps are required only in the selection sort. Why? Because in the selection, if you see the selection sort code, so it will sort the array in the following manner. For example, let's suppose here the array is something like 4, 3, 7, 2 and 9. These are the elements of the array. Okay, now we have to sort this array using the selection sort method. So basically selection sort, what it will do, it will take one variable minimum, and every time it will update this minimum. Okay, so first it will have one loop. Okay, in one single pass we can see the pass by pass analysis of this selection sort. If let's suppose I equals to 0 first. Okay, now I is running from 0 to n minus 1 from this point. Okay, till this point. Now I is this. Okay, so in the first pass minimum will be updated of a of I. Okay, so minimum basically will have the value 4 in starting. Now one j variable we are taking here. Okay, so for j equals to I plus 1 to n minus 1. Okay, now we will compare these two elements, and in every pass we select one position. For example, in this first pass I am selecting this 0th index position. I am selecting this, and I am comparing this element with all the remaining elements, and I am finding the minimum element of these elements. Okay, which is the minimum element. For example, here 4 is greater than 3, so I am updating the minimum here is 3. Okay, minimum here is 3, and I am also saving this minimum index, which is j. Now 7 is greater than 3, 7 is greater than this minimum. Okay, so now minimum is updated to 3. Every time we have to update the minimum and compare the minimum. So in first pass this 7 is compared with this minimum, which is 3. So 3 will remain the minimum. 2, now 2 will come. Okay, so when j will be here, it will take 2. Now if 2 is less than the minimum, it will write 2 here. Okay, now 2 is written here, and the j value is updated. Okay, and every time whenever we find the new minimum, the j value will be, or the index value of that minimum will be updated in one separate location. Let's suppose this is minimum index location, so here it will be updated. Now 9 is greater than the minimum, current minimum, which is 2, so it will not update it. Okay, so after having all the n element scanned, we have find now the minimum value, which is 2, and we have also saved its index, which is 0 1 2 3. Okay, 3 here. So in the first pass, after scanning all the input in first pass, after scanning all the inputs, we just only now we can swap this element. Okay, so now we are swapping this ith location with the minimum index location. Okay, so basically this 2 which is present in the minimum location, which is 3. So I am, after scanning all this, I am swapping these two elements, 4 and 2, this 4 and this 2. Okay, so basically after the first pass our array will be like this, 2 3 7 4 and 9. So we can see here that after scanning, for single pass, one pass, we are swiping only just one time. Okay, so in each time we can update, in each for each pass we are swiping one element, one swiping involved after every pass. Okay, maximum one swiping involved. So there are n pass, okay, from I here 0th location to n minus this location, n minus 2 location. So there are totally n pass, and after each pass we are swiping maximum one time. Okay, so there are only order of n swiping required in the selection sort algorithm. So this is the minimum number of swaps. Okay, so this is minimum number of swaps in selection sort. And if we are considering here the insertion sort, in worst case order of n square swiping will be required. Okay, in quick sort also order of n square swiping will be required, and in heap sort also order of n log n, not order of n square, here n log n swiping are required in heap sort. So the minimum swap number of swaps will be selection sort, in the selection sort. So order of n is the answer for selection sort. This question, given two statements, insertion of an element should be done at the last node of the circular list and deletion of an element should be done at the last node of the circular list. So we have to identify which of the following statements are true. Okay, so we know that circular lists are like this. This, if this is one element and this is the pointer or address part of this node. Okay, so this is one node, this is second node. Second node is pointing to the third node, third node is pointing to the fourth node, and let's suppose this is the last node. Okay, and since this is circular list, okay, so the last node of the circular list will point to the first node. Okay, so this is the circular list like this. This is the structure of the circular list. But in the statement here, insertion of an element should be done at the last node of the circular list. So it is saying basically insertion of an element should be done at the last node. So basically in the circular list there is no concept about the last node, because any one node like this node or this node or this node, any one here is the candidate of the last node, because it is actually the circular list. Okay, so this, okay. So basically in this list, no, and we cannot identify which of the following is last node, which of these which of these nodes are the last node of the circular list, because there is no end points in the circular list, because both the end points are internally connected. So we cannot identify the last node of the circular list. So basically this question here, which is given here, it is a wrong concept question. Okay, so I don't think so this is right question. And in the ISRO examination, they have also deleted this question for the marking criteria. They are not considering this question into marking scheme. Okay, so we cannot discuss this question. In this question, which of the following data structure is useful in traversing a given graph by the breadth first search? Okay, so for this question, we should know about the breadth first search. What is breadth first search? Actually, the breadth first search is a traversing technique in a graph. For example, if we have one graph like this, this is an undirected graph, and A is connected to B, C, and D. Okay, and this B is also connected with E, F, and G, and this D is also connected with H, I, and J. Okay, so now what is meaning by the breadth? Okay, so this is called the breadth, in the same breadth, which B, C, and D are having the same distance, or having the same breadth with A. Okay, because distance of B is from A is 1, distance of C from A is 1, distance of D from A is 1. This E, F, and G having the same breadth with respect to B and also with respect to A, because both E, all of these E, F, G, H, I, J, K, all of these elements having the same breadth from A. Okay, so now in the breadth first search, we can go by increasing order of the breadth. And for example, first A, if A is visited first, then all the elements, all the nodes which are present at the distance 1 from A will be visited next. So here B, C, D will be visited next, and then all the elements which are present at the distance 2 from this A will be visited next. Okay, so E, F, G, H, I, J, this will be visited next. And okay, and one more thing, in the same breadth, for example, this B, C, D, which are the equidistant from A, in these three, order doesn't matter. It is implementation dependent that we can visit B first, or we can visit C first, or we can visit D first. Okay, so it is the implementation dependent. Okay, so no problem about this order, because these are the same at the same distance, so order doesn't matter here. But yeah, first B, C, D should all these will be visited first, then after the distance to nodes, which is E, F, G, H, I, J, K, will visit it next. Okay, so in this question they are saying we have to perform this breadth first search. So what is the data structure which we can use here? So we know that if we have to perform the breadth first search, the useful data structure will be Q. Here we can see that why Q is important here. Okay, so for this we are having one array which is called visited array. Okay, so in this visited array, all the value corresponding to each node, okay, for A, for B, for C, this is actually 0 1 2 3 4 5, like this. But now I am, for illustrating purpose, I am giving here name as A, B, C. This element is corresponding with D, this is for E, this is for F, this is for G, this is for H, I, and then J. Okay, now at starting, each element in this visited array will be 0. Okay, this is Boolean array actually. In this, only two values are possible for each element, either 0 or 1. So 0 represents this all elements are not visited yet. Okay, and now we are using one Q here also. This is Q, it is useful here. We can see that. Okay, so from A we can start the breadth first search with any given node, but we are starting here from A. Okay, so since A is now visited, so I am putting here value of A is 1 because it is visited. Now every nodes which are adjacent to A will be NQ in this queue, will be add or NQ in this queue. So what are the elements which are adjacent to B? So adjacent to A, which is B, C, D. So all these elements B, C, D will be added or enqueued in the queue. Okay, now it's over. Okay, now it is over. Now we have to perform these iteration or these operation until we left one element in the queue. Means until the queue when the queue is having some elements, we have to dequeue that element and perform these iteration. Okay, so since there are three elements in this queue right now, so now I am dequeuing this front element B from queue. Okay, and now queue is also visited. Since since this B is not visited yet, so I am visiting this B and putting the value here 1. Okay, now every nodes which are adjacent to B is also now pushed into the queue or enqueued into the queue. Okay, so what are the elements which are adjacent to B? They are A, E, F, and G. Okay, this is F, A, E, F, G. But those elements which are visited, we should not add them back into the queue. Okay, so since A is the adjacent of B, but it is visited, this value is 1, means A is already visited, so we cannot add this A into the queue. So I am adding only these elements E, F, and G into the queue. Okay, so E, F, G, I am adding these elements. Now since queue is not empty, okay, so again we are dequeuing this element C from the queue. Now C is visited here. Okay, C is visited, so I am putting the value here as 1, means it is now C is visited. Okay, now C is visited. Then D, since Q is not empty, so and also, yeah, we have to check one more thing. Since C see, you have only one adjacent element, which is adjacent node, which is A, and A is already visited, so we are not adding any element into the queue. Okay, so we are now in D. This queue is not empty, so I am dequeuing this D element, visited D, so I am putting the value 1 here. Now, since D have H, I, J and A are the adjacent nodes of D, so I am adding all these elements which are not visited yet into the queue. So since A is visited, so I am not adding this. Again, H, I, J I am adding, so H, I, J will be added into the queue. Okay, so this ND value is 1. Now, since queue is not empty, so again we are popping or we are dequeuing this element E from here. So E is visited, putting the value E as 1 here. Since E have only one adjacent node, which is B, and B is already visited, so I am not adding B here. Okay, again into the queue. So similarly, F, G, H, I, J, all will be visited next. So E, F, G, H, I, J, and all the value of 1, all the value of here will be 1, since they are visited. And since queue is empty now, so we can stop the operation here. So we have visited A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K in this manner. So this is called the breadth first search. First this distance will be covered, then this distance will be covered. And first, or it is also called the level order traversal, because we are doing here visiting the elements in the level by level. Okay, so this is called breadth first search, and the useful data structure here is Q. In this question, how many 128 cross 8 bit RAMs are required to design the 32K cross 32 bit RAM? Okay, so we have to design this much size of RAM, which is of having 32K. It means 32K means these are the address lines of this RAM, 32K. Okay, so 32K or 32 kilo addresses are there, and each address can store 32 bit. Okay, so this is basically one RAM, and we have to design this much size RAM, and we have only this 128 cross 8 bit RAM. Okay, so what is the meaning of this 128 cross 8 bit RAM? It means we have 128 address lines here, and each address cell or each cell can represent each address line having one cell, and each cell can store this 8 bit of data here. Okay, so now if I have to design this much RAM with this available RAM, so simply I have to divide this capacity with 128 divided 128 into 8 bit. So we will get here the number of smaller RAMs required to design this bigger RAM. Okay, so this is 2 to the power 10 plus 5, which is 15, into 2 to the power 5, okay, and now 2 to the power 7 into 2 to the power 3, which is 2 to the power 20 divided by 2 to the power 10. So it means 2 to the power 10, okay, so which means 1024 RAMs will be required here. So answer is B. In this question, the most appropriate matching for the following pair is, so we have given these three two columns, and in each column there is three row. Okay, so we have to match the column. Indirect addressing. Okay, so we know the indirect addressing, what it means. I can explain this with one example. For example, if we have one instruction, which is load accumulator ACC, and in this 5, okay, this 5 is the memory location or address. Okay, so now in this indirect, and we are using here indirect addressing mode, so load the value which is stored in memory location pointed by the operand into accumulator. Okay, so it means we have to load the value. Okay, suppose this is memory array. Okay, so this is 5 location number 5, and in the location number 5, let's suppose the value is 100. Okay, so this 100 means we have to load the value into accumulator, which is stored at the location number 100. Okay, so if this is the location number 100, let's suppose this is location number 100, in 100 there is one value stored, which is 17. Okay, so now 17 will be stored or loaded into accumulator. Okay, so this is the same way as we operate in the pointer. Okay, so indirect addressing is used for the pointers. The second one is immediate addressing. In the immediate addressing, let's suppose this is one instruction which is in which we are using immediate addressing. So this is load, again load, we have to load accumulator. Okay, so load ACC, then this is our operand hash 5. So okay, so this is our operand. So now if we are using the immediate addressing mode, so this 5, which is a constant value, it will directly load into accumulator. Okay, so this is called the immediate addressing, and immediate addressing is used for the constants. So y corresponds to this 3. Okay, immediate addressing corresponds to constants. And the third one is auto decrement addressing. In the auto decrement addressing, the variable will automatically decrement after each step. Okay, so this is the same way we are implementing loop. Okay, so auto decrement addressing will match with the loop. So our option here is right answer will be indirect addressing pointers, immediate addressing means x2. Okay, so this is x2, y, which is immediate addressing constants, so y3, and Z, auto decrement addressing, which corresponds to loop. So this is the right answer. In this question, a cache memory needs an access time of 30 nanosecond and main memory access time is 150 nanosecond. Okay, so we have given these two memory. What is the average access time of CPU? Assume hit ratio equals to 80%. Okay, so in this system only one level of cache is there. Okay, and the cache, if I am assuming the hit ratio of cache 1 is H1 equals to 80%, okay, this is 80%, so H1 will be 80 divided by 100, which is 0.8. okay, so now, and we have given the access time of cache 1, which is I am assuming C1, equals to 30 nanosecond. And the main memory access time, which is I am supposing M, equals to 150 nanoseconds. This is also given in the question. So we have to find the average access time. So average access time will be this. Whenever the word which is CPU wants is present in the cache, then this scenario is called the hit. So okay. So hit, whenever the hit occurs, it will have to search only in the cache, which is C1, and whenever the miss occurs, okay, so miss will occur 1 minus H1 times, or the probability of miss will be 1 minus H1 into if this is miss, then we have to first search on the cache and then we have to go into the main memory, or CPU has to go into the main memory. Okay, so this will C plus M. Now we can put here the values of this H1, C1. So H1 is 0.8 hit probability, 0.8 into access time of cache is 30, plus 1 minus 0.8, which is 0.2, into cache plus main memory time, which is 30 plus 150, which is 180. Okay, so will be 180. So final answer is here 24 plus this one will give 36. Okay, so final answer is here 60 nanoseconds. So this is the right answer. In this question, which one of the following Boolean expressions is not a tautology? Okay, so in this question we have to find which is not a tautology. For this question to be solved, we should know what is actually meant by the tautology. Okay, so actually tautology is the expression which will give always true value. Okay, so if this is the expression it will become a tautology if this expression will give always true value for any combination of these variables or literals A, B and C. Okay, so we have to check now which of these is not a tautology. Okay, so I am checking this A option. So A is given as, this is A implies B, this sign is called implies sign, A implies B and B implies C. Okay, this complete expression, this left hand side implies this, A implies C. Okay, so now if this is the expression. So we should know one thing, there is one rule. This is A implies B is equivalent to not A or B. Okay, so this is the rule, or this both these terms are similar. In A implies B, we can put in A implies B, it is equivalent to not A or B. Okay, so here for solving this question, let's suppose I am using these symbols A bar, and OR is actually plus, so I am using here plus. Okay, because we are familiar with these symbols. Anyway, these both are the same things. Okay, so this complete thing I am assuming it as A, and this complete thing I am assuming it as B. Okay, so it is basically A implies B, so we can write here not A or B, yeah, not A plus B, A complement plus B. So I am putting not against these whole symbol. Okay, so not A implies B and B implies C, complete not, or, because this is not A or B, so or A implies C. Okay, now in this again we can put like this is A implies B. Okay, and we know one thing which is called De Morgan's law. If something like this, not A, not and A and B complete, okay, so A and B complete complement or complete not is equals to not A, and this sign, this AND sign will change into OR sign, not B. Okay, and same thing with the OR. Okay, so not A or B equals to not A AND, because this OR sign is changing into AND sign, not A or not A and not B. Okay, so this is called the De Morgan's law. So the same thing I am applying here, not this term and this term, so it will give not this term or not this term. Okay, so not A implies B or not B implies C, and this is OR, so OR, and this A implies C, it will we can write this as not A or C, so not A or A complement, and I am using here not A or C here. Okay, so this is the expression. Now not A implies B, it will become not A implies B, I can write it as A complement plus B, and this OR, which means actually this is plus sign, so plus, not B complement C, I can write it as not B implies C, which means not B plus C, and this OR I can write it as plus not A, I can write it as A complement, this is OR, so plus C. Okay, so now this is A complement plus B and complete not. Okay, so which means it represents like this. Okay, this is the whole complement of this term. So we know the De Morgan's law, it is saying that the complement of this whole OR term will convert it into the AND term. Okay, so A complement, it will give A plus sign, or OR sign will be changed into AND sign, and this B and complement B. Okay, so B complement plus, this is same thing, not I can write it as B complement plus C whole complement. Okay, so and again I am applying the De Morgan's law here, so it will give B, this plus sign will sign will changing into AND sign, B and C complement, and then plus A complement plus C. Okay, so this is equivalent to A and B bar. Okay, so I am combining these two terms together, A bar and A and B bar, so A bar plus A and B bar plus this C plus B and C complement. Okay, now we know one thing, in the Boolean algebra, the OR, or this sign, this is called the OR or plus, it is distributive over AND sign, which means if there is some expression like this, A plus B into C, it is actually equivalent to A plus B and A plus C. okay. So because this plus is distributive over this AND operation, or this OR operation is distributive over AND operation, and the same thing with this A AND B plus C, okay. Same thing will be applicable. This AND will distributive over OR, okay. So this expression will give A AND B or A AND C, okay. So this thing is valid only for the Boolean algebra or Boolean expressions, okay. So here A plus B and C will be A plus B and A plus C. So now same thing I can apply here. A bar plus A B complement will be A complement plus A and A complement plus B complement. Same thing, okay. I am applying these same thing here in these two terms. A complement plus A and A complement plus B complement. And now C plus B complement, B and C complement, okay. So the same thing here also. So C plus B, which is this plus is distributive over this AND operation. So C plus B and C plus C complement, okay. And we know this A plus A complement, if we are ORing the same term with its complement, it will always give 1, okay. So same thing apply here. A complement plus A, it will give 1, and A complement plus B, so this will remaining like this. A complement plus B complement plus same thing C plus B, and this whole term will become 1, okay. So now this is the final expression, A complement plus B complement plus C plus B. So I can write it as A complement plus B complement plus B. This B I am writing with B complement, then plus C, okay. So this is expression, final expression. So now we can see that this will always represent 1. So it is basically A complement plus 1 plus C, and this whole term will become 1, or this whole term will become true for always, for all value of AC. Why? Because we are ORing these two terms with 1, and whenever we OR any term with 1, it will always give the same, it will always give true or same 1, okay. So this statement is always our tautology, okay. So this is tautology, so this is not our answer, we have to find not a tautology. Then we can check this C statement. A and B and C implies C and A. So yeah, I have to erase here this thing. I am erasing here to solve the C and D option and B option also. So you can see here, one second, yeah, yes, this space is enough now, okay. So now I am solving this C statement. At last I will identify the B, but now I am taking this C statement or C expression, which is given. A and B and C implies C or A, okay. So the same thing I am applying here. This is implies sign. We can write it as this whole terms A B C, not of this, or we can take complement of this and OR. So this is OR C or A, okay. So now I am changing the signs. For example, I will change this sign with AND sign, and this sign OR sign will changing into plus sign, okay. So it will give me value A AND B AND C. OR means plus, C or A, which will give C plus A, okay. So now again applying De Morgan's law in this term, which is complement of A and B and C. So this will give A complement or B complement or C complement, okay. And this will remain same, C plus A, okay. Now you can see that, you can clearly see this C plus C complement, it will give value 1, and whenever we are ORing any term with 1, it will always give 1, value 1 or value true for all variables here, okay. So it is again the tautology. So this is also the tautology. So this will not our answer. The last one is A implies B implies A. So A implies means A implies B implies A. Again I am applying the same rule. A implies this term, okay. So this will give A bar plus this term, okay, same as. So B implies A. So A implies plus, again here applying the same thing, A implies B equals to not A or B. So this will give not B plus A. So now we can combine these two terms together. So we can write these two terms together, B complement plus A complement plus A. This will again give 1 or value true. So ORing with anything which with 1 or true will always give the true value or 1, okay. So it will always true. So this is also the tautology. So this will not our answer. Our answer will be B here. You can solve this statement and it will not give the always true value, okay. So this is our final answer. In this question, what is the minimum number of two input NAND gates used to perform the function of two input OR gate? So we have to perform the function of two input OR gate. So two input OR gate, if I am giving any value like A and B here, it will has to give A or B, okay. So this is the function of two input OR gate, A or B, and we have to implement this gate using the NAND gate. And we know what is NAND gate. If I am giving two inputs A and B here, so NAND gate, output of the NAND gate will be A B whole complement, A and B complement, okay. So it is basically complement or not of AND gate, okay. So A B is AND gate and it is the complement of A B gate. So now we have to derive this, and we can write this as A complement or B complement. Why? Because this is the by using the De Morgan's law here. So A complement plus or B complement, okay. So basically this is, yeah, so basically we have to give both the input as the complement, okay. So if I am giving here A complement into the NAND gate, for example, if I am giving here A complement here and B complement here, so it will give A complement and B complement whole complement. So if I applying De Morgan's law here, so it is similar or it is equivalent to A or B, and this is the same function which we have to implement, okay, by this. So basically in this NAND gate I have to give both inputs in its complement form. So for complementing, if I am using this NAND, and since the circuit can use only NAND gate because we have to implement all these things using only two input NAND gates. So if I am giving here two input as A and A, and since this is NAND gate, it will give me A and A complement, which is actually A complement, okay. So for this A complement I have to use this one NAND gate. So the actual circuit will be, this is our NAND gate and I am supplying this A input here, okay, this is A input. So it will give A complement, the same thing, because I have to apply here B complement. So the same thing I am using here also. So this is B and this will give B complement here, okay. Now this is A complement, this is B complement, okay. And now one and NAND gate also. So after this, since this is A complement and this is B complement, so A complement, B complement, A complement and B complement and whole complement. So it is similar to A or B, okay. So A or B. So this is the final gate which we want, okay. So our answer will be, we are using here three NAND gate. This is 1, 2, and 3. Three NAND gates we are using to implement two input OR gate. So answer is 3. In this question, when two n bit numbers are added, the sum will contain at the most. So we have to tell which how many is the maximum bits. If two n bit binary numbers are added, then on the output or in the sum of that two n bits, what is the maximum number of bits can be present in the sum, okay. So we can take one example. If we have 4-bit binary numbers. We have 2 4-bit binary numbers, okay? And let's suppose the maximum number which can be written in the binary in 4-bit, which is 1111. This is the maximum number of 4-bit binary, and we are adding these, the same number 1111. We are adding these two numbers, okay? Why I am taking this maximum number here, which can be written in 4-bit binary? Because I have to identify how many number of bits will be present in the sum, okay? So 1 plus 1, which is 1 0, so I am putting 0 here and 1 will be carry. Now these 1 1 and 1, it will give as 1 1, which is 3 actually, 1 1. So 1 I am putting here and 1 is carry, again 3, which is 1 1. So 1 I am putting here, 1 as carry, 1 1 1. So 1 carry and 1 here, okay? So you can see clearly, for n bit binary number or for 4 bit binary numbers, the sum will contain at the most 5 bits, okay? 5 bit will be containing by the sum, and it is maximum because we are taking those 2 4 bit binary numbers, maximum 4 bit binary numbers, okay? So it is containing the 5 bits in the sum, okay? So for n bit binary numbers, the sum will contain at the most n plus 1 bits. This is the answer. In this question, if there are n devices or n nodes in a network, what is the number of cable links required for a fully connected mesh and a star topology respectively? Okay, so for this question, we should know about the mesh and star topology. So I'm assuming there are five nodes in our network. So these are the 5 nodes, okay? These are the 5 nodes. So the star topology is actually all the nodes are connected with one centralized server or one centralized node, okay? So this is called the star topology. For example, this is node number 1, node number 2, node number 3, node number 4 and node number 5. So all the nodes, this is our centralized server or centralized node which will keep track of all the nodes. So this is the centralized, okay? So all the remaining nodes, which is 1 2 3 4, will be connected to this centralized server, okay? So this is called the star topology. And what is mesh topology? Mesh topology is actually, if these are the 5 nodes again, so in mesh topology, all are the possible pairs will be connected with each other. So here, how many pairs are possible? Since this is 1 2 3 4 5, let's suppose the name of these nodes are this. So now I am connecting all the possible pairs in this mesh topology. So 1 will be connected to 2, 1 will be connected to 3, 1 will be connected to 4, this one will be connected to 5. Now this 2 will be connected, already connected with 1, 2 will connected with 3, 2 will connected with 4 and 2 will connected to 5. Same thing happens with 3 also. So 3 is already connected with 1, 3 is already connected with 2, 3 is now connected with 4, 3 is connected with 5, and similarly 4 is already connected with 1, with 2, with 3, and with 5 it is not connected, so I am putting 1 edge here. And you can see that this fifth node is already connected to all the remaining nodes. So 5 is connected to 1 2 3 4, okay? So all the remaining nodes, it is connected. This is called the mesh topology, okay? So we can answer the question, how many link or wire is required in this star and mesh topology. So in star topology, it is clearly seen that this is the wire or this is the link, okay, which is connecting the two nodes. So we can answer here, if there are 5 nodes, 4 links are required to connect all with this centralized server. So this is n minus 1, okay? Answer of this question, star topology, if n nodes are present, then n minus 1 cable links will be required. And for this nc2, if there are n nodes are present, so we are choosing 2 each, okay? So how many different number of pair possible? So nc2, which is actually n into n minus 1 by 2, okay? So these many wire or these many links will be required to connect it into the mesh topology system. So answer is, for mesh, n into n minus 1 by 2, and for star, n minus 1. So answer is this. In this question, if there are n devices or n nodes in a network, what is the number of cable links required for a fully connected mesh and a star topology respectively? Okay, so for this question, we should know about the mesh and star topology. So I'm assuming there are five nodes in our network. So these are the five nodes, okay? These are the five nodes. So the star topology is actually all the nodes are connected with one centralized server or one centralized node, okay? So this is called the star topology. For example, this is node number 1, node number 2, node number 3, node number 4 and node number 5. So all the nodes, this is our centralized server or centralized node which will keep track of all the nodes. So this is the centralized, okay? So all the remaining nodes, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, will be connected to this centralized server, okay? So this is called the star topology. And what is mesh topology? Mesh topology is actually, if these are the five nodes again, so in mesh topology, all are the possible pairs will be connected with each other. So here, how many pairs are possible? Since this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, let's suppose the name of these nodes are this. So now I am connecting all the possible pairs in this mesh topology. So 1 will be connected to 2, 1 will be connected to 3, 1 will be connected to 4, this one will be connected to 5. Now this 2 will be connected, already connected with 1, 2 will connected with 3, 2 will connected with 4 and 2 will connected to 5. Same thing happens with 3 also. So 3 is already connected with 1, 3 is already connected with 2, 3 is now connected with 4, 3 is connected with 5, and similarly 4 is already connected with 1, with 2, with 3, and with 5 it is not connected. So I am putting 1 edge here, and you can see that this fifth node is already connected to all the remaining nodes. So 5 is connected to 1, 2, 3, 4, okay? So all the remaining node, it is connected. This is called the mesh topology, okay? So we can answer the question, how many link or wire is required in this star and mesh topology? So in star topology, it is clearly seen that this is the wire or this is the link, okay, which is connecting the two nodes. So we can answer here, if there are five nodes, four links are required to connect all with this centralized server. So this is n minus 1, okay? Answer of this question, star topology, if n nodes are present, then n minus 1 cable links will be required. And for this NC2, if there are n nodes are present, so we are choosing 2 each, okay? So how many different number of pair possible? So NC2, which is actually n into n minus 1 by 2, okay? So these many wire or these many links will be required to connect it into the mesh topology system. So answer is, for mesh, n into n minus 1 by 2, and for star, n minus 1. So answer is this. In this question, which protocol suite designed by IETF? This is IETF to provide security for a packet at the internet layer. So we are talking about here the internet layer, and at the internet layer, which is the security protocol? So the answer is here IPsec, okay? IP security protocol or IPsec protocol is used to provide security for a packet at the internet layer, okay? So answer is IPsec, and this, okay, so answer is here IPsec. And this SSL is also one security protocol, okay, which is called security shell protocol, but it is the application layer protocol in TCP/IP, okay? In TCP/IP suite, it is the application layer protocol, which SSL. So it is not our answer. IPsec will work at the network layer or internet layer. So the answer is IPsec. In this question, pretty good privacy, PGP, is used in, okay? So PGP or pretty good privacy provides cryptographic privacy and authentication for data communication. So whenever there are data communication involved, it means data is sending from one host to another host, so this is called data communication, then PGP is used to provide the cryptographic privacy there, okay? And the main use of PGP is for the email security of email or encrypting and decrypting text, emails, etc. So PGP is used for generally this encrypting and decrypting of text, emails, etc. So this is designed for the email security. So this PGP is used in email security. This is answer.
Question number 39 from ISRO paper. And question number 39 says, estimation of software development effort for organic software in basic COCOMO model. So what is COCOMO model? COCOMO is a model to find the effort in software development. Okay, so we have efforts and we do effort estimation, cost estimation and benefit estimation in every software development. So we have different models for effort estimation, and effort estimation can be done in many ways, like function count or by counting the lines, LOC, that is line of code. LOC is line of code. So, and KLOC means kilo lines of code, which means 1000 line of code is known as KLOC. So in COCOMO model, we have a direct formula for calculating the effort, ease effort, and the formula is 2.4 into KLOC. KLOC is line of codes. Okay, we count the line of codes in a program, and the power is 1.05 PM. So this is the effort estimation using the COCOMO model. So COCOMO model is used to calculate to find the effort taken in the software development. So according to this, option C is correct for this question. Question number 39. Question number 40 says, XPath is used to navigate through element and attributes in which kind of documents? So what is XPath? XPath is a library, and this library contains at least 200 functions. And what is the functionality of these functions? XPath is a library used with XML. Okay, XML. XPath means XML path. Okay, XML path. So in this, what we do is, in XML, we know that XML, we use XML to carry the data on the web. So if you want to carry data from database to your web page and web page to database, to carry this data from database to web page or web page to database, we put the data into the XML document and then save it to the database or bring to the document, to the web document. So in XML, we have different nodes. Like we have root. For example, you have a table. Then inside table, you will have some column, let's say student name. Then inside the student name, you have some value like ABC. So this is your root node. This is child and this is grandchild of this node. So these are the nodes. To access these nodes, we use XPath. Okay, XPath is a library of 200 functions. So XPath is definitely used in XML documents. So B option is correct for question number 40.
In this question, we have given one C program or C code, and we have to identify what will be the output of this C program, C++ program. Okay, so in this question, we start the execution from main. Okay, so in main, there is one local variable which is called number. Okay, it is defined as number equals to 30. So one local variable number memory will allocate to this, and the initialization of this is being done by 30. So I am writing here the value 30 as number. Okay, now we are calling this function square ampersand number and ampersand number. These are the two arguments. Okay, so we are passing the address. Let's suppose the address of this is 1000. At memory location 1000, this number is stored, which is having value 30. So I am passing here by call by reference. Okay, so because I am giving call, I am giving the reference or address of this number variable here. This ampersand denotes the address of number, and this ampersand denotes address of number. This is called the address of operator. Okay, so now this function square will be called. So square, yeah, we can match. This is not the right here. It is using the polymorphism. but this square is not right because here argument number of argument is 1 and here number of argument is 2. So this accordingly this square will be called here, and whenever when this square function is called, it is accepting the address of this number in two pointers x and y. Okay, so there are two pointers x and one is y, and those two is containing the address of this number, which is 100. Okay, so basically these two pointers pointing the value, same value, this number. Okay, so these two pointers are pointing the same variable number. Now in this line, in this instruction, it is giving value at x. This is called the value at operator. Okay, value at that address. So value at this x which is a pointer, equals to value at x into, this is into operator, binary operator, multiplication, it is into or multiplication operator, and minus minus star y. Okay, so what it corresponds to, since this is the unary operator minus, so precedence will be first there is one bracket or parenthesis operator here. Okay, so if we are executing this in the order of precedence, so the higher precedence of only this parenthesis, and the parenthesis operator has the highest priority here, and since there are two parentheses, this one and this one, so the associativity is used here. And since we know the associativity of the parenthesis operator is left to right, so left to right it will execute. Okay, so first this left parenthesis will be executed. So star x means value at that pointer x, or value at this address x, and x is containing address 1000, so value at this address 1000 is 30, which is number. Okay, so here it will put 30 here. Multiplication, I am not going to apply the multiplication here now, because the higher precedence operator is this parenthesis. This is not this parenthesis, and same this parenthesis, which means value at y and value at location 1000, okay, which is 30. But since here we are and the second most higher priority operator is unary operator. Okay, after this parenthesis, this unary operator will execute it next. Okay, so unary, and this is pre decrement operator. Okay, so it will decrement the value of this number 29 and then uses this value as here in the second operand. So 29 will be used here. Okay, so 30 into 29, and 29 is present in the number. Okay, now because of this decrement, pre decrement operator. Now if these two now only operator left is multiplication, so it will multiply these two operator, so it will give value as 13 to 29, which is 870, and we are putting this 870 value at the location of pointed by x. Okay, because the left hand side of the expression is left hand side, or this left hand side of this equal operator or assigning operator is value at x. So value at location x, which is 1000, so value at this location 1000 will be updated as 870 here. Okay, so now number which is this number having the value 870, so now this, since this function is completed, it will again go to this main function. Control will come here again, and then we are printing here cout number. Okay, so value of number is now 870, so it will print 870 as the answer. So this is right, 870 is the answer. In this question, which of the following operators cannot be overloaded? So first we have to know what is the meaning of this overloading. So operator overloading is actually if one operator can be performed more than one task in different situations. For example, this plus operator can behave to other and it can perform two different operations. For example, since because this plus operator is overloaded in C++, so how it is overloaded, this plus operator can perform the addition of these two integers. Okay, so 4 plus 5 equals to 9, this is one operation, or this is one behavior of this plus operator. And since it is overloaded in the string class also, so we can concatenate these two strings, for example ABC in C++, in ABC, this is one string ABC plus this is one string XYZ. So here we are using this plus operator here, okay, and this plus operator will perform the concatenation of these two strings here, okay. So this will give ABC XYZ. So this plus operator is performing more than one task in C++, so it is called the operator overloading. So plus operator is overloaded in the C++. But here, which of the following operators cannot be overloaded? So here this dot operator or member access or dot operator, it is not overloaded. Ternary operator is also not overloaded in the C++ or in any language, and scope resolution operator is also not overloaded. So the right answer is here all of the above, since these three operations cannot be overloaded. So this is the right answer. In this question, which of the following is associated with objects? Okay, so in the object oriented programming paradigm, what are the attributes which will be associated with objects? Okay, so state is the characteristic one attribute which is associated with objects, and this state represents the data or value of an object. Let's suppose we have one object of the banking system. Let's suppose this is one banking system, okay, and we have one object of this banking system, okay. So state, there are some customers in this banks, okay. So for each customer we have one object, okay. So this is the customer one, and this is the object. So the value associated with this objects with this customer, for example name of this customer, age of this customer, and account number of this customer, so these all the associated with states, okay. So it will tell the state of the object. So state is one of the attribute or one of the characteristic of object. The second thing is behavior, okay. So behavior is also one attribute which is associated with objects. So basically behavior represents the functionality of an object. For example, this customer can deposit some amount into the bank, or it can withdraw some amount, okay. So there are some functionality, so it will represent the behavior, okay. So behavior is actually functionality related with objects. So behavior is also associated with object. The third one is identity, okay. So here object ID is typically implemented via unique ID, okay. So every object is recognized by some unique ID into the machine, okay. The value of this ID is not visible to external user, okay. And this ID is not visible, okay. We cannot, if an external user wants to fetch the unique ID of this object, it will not allow. This system will not allow to see this user this object's ID. Okay, so this object ID is not visible for the external user. But it is used internally by the JVM. Okay, so if I am talking about the Java machine, okay, Java language. In Java, there is one Java virtual machines. Okay, so this ID is very important in ID of the object is very important, because through this ID the JVM will identify which each object uniquely. Okay, so this JVM will identify each objects uniquely with the identity of objects. Okay, so this is also associated with objects. So final answer is all of the above. In this question, which of these is characteristic of RAD5? Okay, so this RAD5 is one architecture which is used in the distributed package. This basically this RAD5, RAD4, all of these types are used in the file accessing. Okay, so you can refer this link to read about this RAD5, and the main concern here is the characteristic of RAD5 is distributed parity. So answer is distributed parity here. This one is our answer.
Question number 47 says, capability maturity model is a methodology to what? Develop and refine an organization's software development process, or developing the software, or testing the software. So what is CMM model? CMM model is used to refine the software development process. You are developing a software using some software model. Okay, we have process models. For example, we have different process models. Life cycle models. Okay, they are life cycles models. Process means set of activities which we are using to develop a software. In process management, we have like waterfall model. And like prototype model. So like this, we have different models in software engineering and spiral models. We have many models. So when we are developing a software, we do the software management in the paralleling. Okay, so we do software project management with the process development. These two things are done in parallel. So capability maturity model is a software project model which is used to refine the software process model. Okay, you are in a stage, let's say you are in a software requirement stage. So in this software requirements stage, you will use capability model to actually increase the output of this stage. So CMA model is used to increase the performance of a software development process. Okay, you are using waterfall model, and if you are using capability maturity model, CMA model, with this process model, then what you can do is you can identify the errors which can be in waterfall model, and you can simply find how can I improve my software development process. Okay, so this is the way to improve your software development process. So option is correct for this question: develop and refine an organization's software development process.
In this question, what problem is solved by Dijkstra's banker's algorithm? Okay, so we know that Dijkstra's banker's algorithm can solve the problem of this deadlock avoidance. Okay, so in the deadlock avoidance, basically banker's algorithm pretends to have allocated the required resources to the process. Okay, so they have allocated the required resources to the process, but they will allocate, and if the system doesn't lead to deadlock, it actually allocates the resources. So in the avoidance, this deadlock avoidance, in banker's algorithm, first the system will check if the system will give some resources, some required resources to the process, and if it this state is not leading to the deadlock state, then they will then it is called the safe state, and then only the system will allocate those resources, those required resources, to the process. Okay, so this is the problem of deadlock avoidance, and it is solved by Dijkstra's banker's algorithm. Okay, in this question, we have to find the number of swappings needed to sort the numbers. These are the given numbers, and we have to sort these numbers in the ascending order using bubble sort algorithm. Okay, so while using the bubble sort algorithm, we know that in the bubble sort algorithm, each time every two consecutive elements will be compared, and if these two and in this comparison, if the greater element is on the left side of the array, so it will immediately swap those two elements. Okay, for example, this is our array 8 22 7 9 31 5 and 13. I'm taking here one variable which is swap count. Okay, so I'm using here count variable. It will keep track the number of swappings needed to sort the numbers. Okay, so in the starting, this is the array 8 22 7 9 31 5 and 13. Okay, so first these two consecutive elements, okay, these two position, this position and this position is compared, which is, and in this comparison, 8, since 8 is lesser, and 8 is also present in the left side of this 22, so no need to swapping done here. Okay, again this will increment. Okay, now this 22 and 7, so 22 and 7, if we are comparing these two consecutive elements, these two positions, every time two consecutive positions will be compared. Okay, so now these two consecutive positions are comparing, and since this 22 is greater than 7, so here one swapping is required. Okay, so you can see that we are swapped here 8 7 22 9 31 5 and 13. Okay, so here I am updating the count as 1. Before it, the count was 0, but now it is incrementing one value. Okay, so count is 1. Now again, since these two positions are compared, so now I have to compare these two positions, 22 and 9. And since 22 is again greater than 9, so again one swapping is required here. So now 9 will come here and 22 will come here. So 8, 7, 9, 22, remaining elements are same. So here I am updating the count, which is 2. Now these two positions will be compared. So 8, 7, 9, 22, 31. Since 22 is less than 31, so it no need to swapping done here. Okay, no need to apply the swap here. And now these two positions 31 and 5 will be compared. And since we can see here clearly that 31 is greater than 5, so we have to swap these two elements. So now count, swap count is 3, and I am swapping this value 8, 7, 9. 22 is perfect, but here 31 and 5. So I have to done here swapping. So 5, 31 and 13. Okay. Now at last in the first, this is only continuing the first pass only. Okay. And in first pass, these many swaps are done till now. Now the last two positions 31 and 30 will be compared, and we can see here that 31 is greater than 13, so we have to swap these two elements and we have to update the swap count as 4. So after having the first pass, or after ending the first pass, our array will be like this: 8, 7, 9, 22, 5, then 13, and then 31. Okay. So this will be our array. Now this is the array after first pass. Okay, this is the first pass only. Now in the second pass, again we have to start the comparison of two consecutive elements. Okay, so in the second pass, these two consecutive elements, these two positions will again be compared. And here we can notice one thing: after each pass, for example, after the first pass, the highest element of this array will be at correct position, or will be at the last position. Okay, and this 31, which is the highest element, now it is in the correct position. Okay, so now in the second pass, again we are comparing these 8 and 7. Since 7 is less than 8, so we have to done here swapping. So our array will be now 7, 8, 9, 22, 5, 13, 31. Again one swapping is required, so I am updating the count as 5. Now these two position 8 and 9, it is in perfect position because 8 is less than, and it is in the left side of the 9. 9 and 22 perfect. 22 and 5, we have to perform swapping here. Okay, so our array will be 7, 8, 9, 5 will become here 22, then 13, then 31. Okay, so the count is now 6. Now these two is compared, so these two position 5 and 13 in the updated array, which is 13 and 22. Okay, so these two positions we have to compare, and since 22 is greater and which is in the left side, so we have to apply the swap here. So now again our array will be 7, 8, 9, 5, 13 will come here, and 22, and then 31, and I am updating the swap count as 7. Okay, so here 13 and 22, and since 31 is in the correct position after applying the first pass, so in the second pass we don't need to consider this 31 element or the last element. Okay, so our second pass is also completed. Now after applying the second pass, we can see that this 22, which is the second largest element in the array, is now in the correct position. Okay, so swap count is 7, and array will be, after second pass, array will be like this. Okay, now again in the third pass, we are again comparing these two position, which is 7, 8, it is in the perfect position. 8, 9, it is also good. Now 9 and 5. Okay, so since you can see that this 5 is a smaller element and it is in the right side of 9, so we have to apply the swap here. So 7, resulting array will be 7, 8, 9, 7, 8, 5. Since 5 is smaller, 5, 9, 13, 22, and 31. These are in the correct position. Okay, and we have to update swap count also, because we have done one swap. So 8 is now swap count. These two positions are compared. Now these two position 9 and 13, which is already in the right position because 9 is less than 13. Okay, so this is the ending of third pass, and you can see that these three elements are now in the correct position. It's correct position, and swap count is 8. Now in the fourth pass, now it is starting the fourth pass, and in the fourth pass, first these two elements will be compared. It is in the right position because 7 is less, and in the left side of 8. 8 and 5, yes, this is wrong because here 5 is the lesser element and it is present right side of the 8. So we have to perform one swapping here. So now swap count will be 9. Okay, so and we are updating the array 7, 5, 8, 9, 13, 22 and 31. Okay, these three are the correct position, in their correct position. Now we have compared these. Now we are comparing these two, and since 8 is smaller and 8 is left side in the line, so we don't need to swap these two elements. Okay, so and since these three are in the correct position, so this is the ending of the fourth pass also. So this is ending of fourth pass, and we can see that the fourth highest element, which is 9, will be now in the correct position. So after applying the fourth pass, our array will be like this: 7, 5, 8, 9, 13, 22 and 31. Okay, and these four elements are in their correct position, and swap count is 9. Now again in the fifth pass we are applying the comparison here, 7 and 5, and since 5 is lesser than 7, so we need to swap these two elements. Okay, so swap count is updated as 10, and 5 will come here, 7 will go here, and 8, 9, all the elements, remaining elements are same. Now we have compared these two positions. Now we have to compare these two positions. So since 7 is less than 8 and it is in the left side, so no need to perform the swap here. And again in the after having the fifth pass, all the 5 greater element will be in the correct position. Okay, and swap count is 10 here. Now in the last pass we have to compare only these two. Okay, and since 5 and 7 is in the right position, so no need to apply the swap. So totally here array is sorted now: 5, 7, 8, 9, 13, 22, 31. So since array is sorted and the swap count is 10, so we need to do swapping 10 number of times. Okay, so number of times swapping needed is 10 in the bubble sort. In this question we have given this tree, and we have to identify the correct position of this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 if the post order traversal gives AB minus CD star. Okay, so we have given one post order traversal, which is AB minus CD star and plus. Okay, so this is the post order traversal. Then the level of the nodes 1, 2, 3 will be. Okay, so what is the level of nodes if this is the post order traversal? Okay, so what is the post order traversal is actually post order traversal is, we have to if we are going from 1 here, okay, so we have to first visit 1, and no need to print 1 since this is post order. We have to print any node whenever it is visited at the last time. Okay, for example here 2 is visited first time, so no need to print. 4 is visited first time, no need to print. And after this 4, this is null and this is null, so 4 will visited here second number of time. Now 4 is visited here last number of time. Okay, so whenever this is the last number of time, 4 is visited last number of time, so then we have to print this 4. Okay, so it is clear that this fourth position is now A, because A is printed first. And in this scenario we can see that in the post order traversal here 4 will be this, I'm supposing this node name is 4, it is visited it will be printed first. Okay, now 2 is visited the second number of time, so no need to print. 5 is visited first number of time, no need to print. Again 5 is visited second number of time, no need to print. Now 5 is visited last time. Okay, so whenever any node visited last time, it has to print in the post order traversal. So now 5 will be printed. Now this 2, you can see that this 2 is now the third number or the last number of time this node 2 is visited, so we have to print 2 here. Okay, so node number 2 will be here. Now 1 is visited second number of time, no need to print. 3 is visited first number of time, no need to print. 6 is visited first number of time, no need to print. Now again this is null. 6 is visited second number of time, no need to print. Now 6 is visited last time. Okay, so 6 is visited last time, so we need to print 6 here. Okay, so 6 will be here. Now this 3 is visited second time, no need to print. 7 is visited first time, no need to print. These two are null, okay? This is null, this is null. Now 7 is visited second number of time, now 7 is visited last time, okay? Since 7 is visited last here, we have to print here 7. Now you can see that 3 is visited last time, so we have to print here 3. And now at last 1 is present, 1 is visited last time. This is root and this is visited last time, so we need to print 1 here, okay? So this is the post order traversal of any tree, okay? So so whenever you need to find the post order traversal, you have to follow this left to right, okay? From top to bottom, this is top to bottom in a manner in which you have to go from root top to bottom and left to right. And whenever you have to whenever you are visiting the last time any node, whenever you are visiting any node last time, you have to print that node, okay? So this 4 5 2, this will be the sequence, okay? And since in the question they are given that this sequence is similar to this sequence, so we can arrange that this is 1 and 1, this is 1, okay? Last one is 1, so 1 is now plus, so plus will be visited, plus will be 1, okay? Plus equals to 1. This now third, okay? So this star will be node number 3. So the star hai, this star will be node number 3 here. This is node number 3, okay? And this 2, okay? So 2 is minus, these corresponds to 2, okay? So 2 is minus, so we can compare this, and our right answer is like this. Plus is node number 1, then minus is node number 2, so these two are right. Now star is node number 3, this is also right. Now we can see 4, okay? This fourth node is A, this corresponds to A, so A is the node number 4. 5, okay? 5, number 5, node number 5 is actually B, so B is here. Node number 6 is, you can see here, it is 6, C, so C is the node number 6. And D, you can see that this 7th correspond to node number D, okay? So D is the 7th. So this is our right answer of the labels, okay? So label of nodes 1, 2, 3 will be like this, plus minus star. This is our final answer. In this question, what is the output of the following program? So we have to tell the output of this code, okay? So first, this main function will execute. So in main, there is one variable int a equals to 10. So I am defining one variable a which is having the value 10. Now if this this is the if condition, if, and this is condition, and then this, okay? So in the condition it is giving here fork equals to 0. So this is the fork system call. This is basically one system call, fork. So what will it do? It will actually allocate one new process, or it will create one new process, and this new process having the same code of this parent process. So this is called the parent process, and exactly the copy of this, okay, exactly a copy of this code will be generated, and that process is called the child process, and this child process is also having the same code. Now if this child process is again now created, okay, so this is the child process, and it will execute the its run, and since it is having the same code, so again a will be here 10, okay? So this a belongs to the parent process, and this a belongs to the child process, okay? So this is child and this is parent process, okay? So now in the fork system call, this child will execute after the fork system call, okay? So this child will execute, or this child will begin its execution from this point, okay? So a plus plus, okay? So if I suppose I am executing the child process, so it will execute this a plus plus instruction, because it will execute after this fork statement. So a plus plus is now 11, okay? But if I am executing, or CPU executing, the parent process, this parent process will not execute this a plus plus. Why? Because this fork system will return some process ID, okay? So fork system call will return process ID to the parent process, and this process ID is not equals to 0 actually. Okay, this process ID PID will be 0 only for this child process. Okay, this is 0 only for child process, but this is not 0. This is some value PID will not be 0 for the parent process. Okay, so when this fork system call return the parent process of PID, so since this PID equals to 0, this condition is false. So when this condition is false in the parent process, so it will not execute A++. It will directly execute this statement, which is printf %d A. So it will print the value as 10. And since the child process will begin its execution from this point, so it will increment this value 10 to the 11. And now it will print again same print A, which is 11. So this code will print 10 and 11 here. In this question, we have given one reference string. Reference string means a program is referring these pages in order. Okay. So how many page faults will occur? These are the number of pages and this is the page numbers. For example, this is page number 0, page number 9, page number 0, this is called the reference string. So how many page faults will occur if the program has 3 page frames available to it and it uses an optimal replacement? Okay, so what it means actually, so program has, or this memory system has 3 pages or 3 page frames in the main memory. Okay, so this is page number, this is frame number 0, frame number 1 and frame number 2. These 3 are the physical frames, okay, in the memory or in the main memory RAM. Now since this 0 is coming, okay, so 0 will allocate, 0 page number 0 will allocate in one of the free space or one of the free frame, which is 0. Now 9 is coming, so page number 9 is coming, so I can allocate 9 here, and then again 0 is coming, so this is not page fault because 0 is already in our memory. Now 1 is coming, 1 will be present here. 8 is coming now. Okay, so now we can see that requirement of page number 8 is coming, and this page number 8 is not available in our memory, so this is called the page fault. Okay, this is called page fault, and we have to replace one of the available pages in the memory, from the memory. Okay, and for replacement we are using optimal replacement algorithm. Okay, so what is optimal replacement? In optimal replacement we will replace that page from the memory which will not refer for the longest number of time. Okay, for the longest time in future. Okay, for example, here if we are seeing this, we have 0, 9 and 1. These three pages are present, 0, 9 and 1. Okay, so we see here which will be in the last. Okay, it means which page is present is not coming for the longest time, and that page will be replaced. Okay, so we can see here 0, okay, 0, 9 and 1. So since 0 and 9 both will not come in future, we can see this reference string, and 0 and 9 both are not coming in the future, so we will replace any one of these 0 or 9. Okay, so I am, and since one we cannot replace one because one is present here. Okay, so one will come again in future, so I am not replacing one here. So any one of these two, 0 and 9, we can replace. So let's suppose we are replacing this 0. Okay, so in place of 0 I will allocate this process, this page number 8 here. Okay, now again 1 is coming and 1 is present in the memory. Again 8 is coming, 8 is already present in memory. Now 7 is coming. Okay, but we are not having the space available for 7, so we have to replace again one page. Okay, so we can see again for this 7. Okay, so since 8 will be our next page request, so we are not replacing this 8 from memory because it will come again. Okay, now 1, since 1 is already present, or 1 will come in future again, so I am also not replacing this 1. Only option is left is 9, since 9 will not come in future anywhere. Okay, so I am replacing this 9, and I will allocate 7 here. Okay, so for this 7 I have allocated now. Now again 8 is already present in memory, 7 is already present, this one is already present, so no page fault here. Now 2 is coming and 2 is not present in memory, so page fault occurring here. Okay, and for 2 we have to again make space for this page 2, so we'll not replace this 8. Okay, this 8 will not replace this 8 because 8 is coming again, 8 will come again. Okay, and then 7 is also coming again, this 7 is will also come again, so I am not replacing 7 also, so I'll replace this 1 and I'm placing 2 here. Okay, so now 2 is present, 8 is already present, then 2 is already present, then this 7 is request of 7 is coming and 7 is already present in the memory, so no page fault. Then 8 is already present, no page fault. 2 is already present, no page fault. Now this 3 is coming and we don't have any space to allocate 3 here in the memory, so what we'll do, we'll replace one of these 3 pages. Okay, so what is the best option or best choice to replace any page? So since we can see here in the future 8 is coming, so we cannot replace this 8 here, and 2 and 7 is not coming in the future. Okay, because this is the last string or last page. Okay, so we can replace any of these 2. So let's suppose I'm replacing this 7, and instead of 7 I'm allocating the place to 3. Now 8 is in the memory and 3 is in the memory, again this 3 coming, 3 is in the memory, so the total number of page faults are, this 0 is one page fault, so 1 2 3, then this is one page fault, 4 5 6 and 7. So right answer is 7. 7 is the number of page faults if we are using optimal replacement here. In this question, in a doubly linked list, the number of pointers affected for an insertion operation will be. Okay, so we know the structure of doubly linked list. If this is one node in doubly linked list, so this doubly linked list has two pointer or two address of, one is for previous and the other, another one is for next node. Okay, so this is doubly linked list basically, and this node, if this is node number 1, this is node number 2, so this node will have also two address parts. One part is referring to the previous node. Okay, so one part is containing the address of the previous node, so this is pointing this, and the next part will pointing to the next node. Okay, again this is same here, the node number 3, this is this. Okay, so this is node number 3. Now this 3 will point to the next part of the 3 will point to the fourth node, this is fourth node, and the previous part or previous pointer of this fourth node will point to the third node. Okay, and since this is the last, if we are assuming there are 4 nodes in the doubly linked list, so we can put here null since it is not pointing anywhere. And in the previous, okay, and in the previous pointer of the first node is will again null. Why? Because no node is present in the previous of one. Okay, so this is the structure of doubly linked list. Now if we have to insert, we have to insert one node here. Okay, one node we have to insert in this doubly linked list. So how many number of pointers are affected for an insertion operation? This is the question. Okay, so it is basically asking what is the number of pointers we have to make change, or we have to modify the number of pointers so that this node will insert into the doubly linked list. Okay, so let's suppose I am inserting this node number, let's suppose the node is here, I am calling this as A, so I have to insert this node between 1 and 2. Okay, so what will it do? Since this is this node A, okay, it is next to the node number 1, so the previous pointer of this node will point to the node number 1. Okay, so I will point this here. Okay, so this is one pointer which we are modified, so pointer count is now 1, which is updated, and then the next pointer of this node will point to this second node. Okay, so second pointer count is updated, is second updated pointer count is second. Now since this one node, the next node of this node will be this, so I am changing here this pointer, it will point to this pointer, this node, And again, this previous node of this node number 2 will be this. So I will change this pointer so that it can point this pointer. Okay. So totally we have updated here 3 and 4. So totally we have changed 4 number of pointers. So insertion operation will be affected 4 number of pointers in any condition. If we are inserting the node here, so you can try, it will change 4 pointers. If you are inserting a node in the last position, so again it will affect the 4 number of pointers is 4. So answer will be 4. Okay, so this is right answer. In this question we have given one code segment void swap int a int b, and this is the code. And in order to exchange the values of two variables x and y, let's suppose we have one main function here, I'm supposing here, and we have two variables int a equals to 5 and int b equals to 10. Okay, so these are the two variables which we are allocated value and also initialized its value. So this variable a is allocated in memory and it is having the value as 5, and this b is value 10. Okay, b is having the value 10. Now I am calling this function swap int a comma int b. Okay, so I am calling here swap, and I am passing these two variables a comma b here. Okay, and I want to since question is saying in order to exchange the value of two variables x and y, so I want to change these value of these two variables, or I want to swap these two variables. Okay, it means after executing the program, this a value will a will have value 10 and this b should have value 5. Okay, so this is our required program. Now if I call this function swap a comma b, okay, so since this is called by value function, okay, this is called by value, so when we call any function in call by value, so there will be allocate to new memory. Okay, so here to new memory a and b will be allocated. Okay, since this is call by value, so to new memory a and b will be allocated. And in the question we have given, we have to swap x and y. Okay, so I will allocate this x and I will assume this variable's name is y. Okay, so this is actually x and y, and we have to change value of these two. Okay, now since this is call by value, so new copy will be generated, new memory will be generated for these two variables a and b, and exact same value, which is x is having 5, so a will have value 5 and b this y having 10 value, so b will have 10. Okay, so exact copy will be generated here or will be allocated here. Okay, now in this code int temp, okay, so we are allocating one temp variable also, and in temp we are allocating a, we are initializing temp as a, so value 5 will be go into temp, then a equals to b, so in this a value will be now 10 and b equals to temp, so in this b value will be now temp. Okay, so temp value is 5, so 5 will be updated here. So is it process right? No, because x and y are untouched here. Okay, x and y are same. Okay, as they were before the function calling, the same value will be present after the function calling also, because this function is call by value. Okay, and in call by value no effect will happen in this arguments. This is called the actual arguments, and these are the formal arguments. Okay, so in call by value no changes occur in the actual argument, so x and y will remain same. Okay, so 5 and 10 will be remain, so we cannot swap here. It is the answer, swap xy cannot be used as it does not return any value. No, this is not right. Swap xy cannot be used as the parameters are passed by value. Since parameters are passing here with mechanism passed by value, so that's why swap xy cannot be used here. Okay, so this is right. In this question we have given one C statement declare, which is int star f int star. Okay, so we have to tell which of the following options are right here. These type of questions we can solve with the help of operator precedence. Okay, since we know that in these operators this parenthesis is having the highest priority or highest precedence. Okay, so and the since there are two parentheses, this one and this one, so we know that the associativity of parenthesis operator is left to right. So we'll solve the left parenthesis first and then right one. Okay, so in the left parenthesis it is saying f star. So basically star means a pointer. Okay, so f is a pointer variable. Okay, we can assume this one till now. So f is a pointer. Now in the second parenthesis, this int. Okay, so this is actually the function calling signature. This is the signature of function calling, that this and now or parenthesis. Okay, so this is actually function. So now we can assume that a pointer to a function. So this f will be a pointer to a function, and in the signature of function it is showing that this function is accepting, or this function's argument is integer star. Okay, so we can say that a pointer to a function that takes an integer pointer as arguments, because in the inside the parenthesis there this is called the argument. Okay, so this function which is pointed by a pointer f is taking an integer pointer as arguments, because argument is int star. So it is taking an integer pointer as argument, and this is the return type. Okay, so this is the return type of function, and this function will return an integer. Okay, so this is the right answer: a pointer to a function that takes an integer pointer as argument and returns an integer. So this is correct. In this question it is saying mutual exclusion problem occurs. Okay, so mutual exclusion problem occurs between two disjoint processes that do not interact. It is not right among processes that share resources. This is right. Okay, so mutual exclusion means if there are some resources which are in the shared manner in some process, among some process. For example, there are some process like P1, P2, P3 and P4, and they are using the shared resource, which is A. This is one shared variable. Okay, this can be anything related a variable or memory or printer or any device. Okay, so this resource can be anything, and if this A is shared between these four process, P1, P2, P3, P4, it means any one of the following process can access this variable or this resource. Okay, so here mutual exclusion problems may occur. What it will be, if let's suppose this P1 process is writing into A, let's suppose the value of A is 4 and P1 is updating the value of A is it is incrementing the value and it will updated as 5. Okay, so when the process is when this process P1 is updating the variable 5, no process can read this value at the time of updation, because if the process P1 is writing into the A and at the same time this P2, P4 or P3 or any other process is reading the value A, then there will be data inconsistency in the system. Okay, so data inconsistency means data will not write after all the execution happened. Okay, so this is called the mutual exclusion problem. It means if there are some shared variables or shared resources, then they will be allocated to the process in the mutual exclusive manner. It means whenever one process is accessing that variable or that resource, then no other process is allowed to access those resources simultaneously. This is called the mutual exclusion problem. Okay, so mutual exclusion problem occurs when among process that share resources. So this is right. In this question we have given this number which is present in the octal number system. So value of this number is 1217, which is in octal number system, and we have to convert it into the equivalent hexadecimal number. Okay, so first we will convert this number, this octal number, into binary number, because we know that in each digit in the octal number system can be represented as a 3-bit binary number. Okay, so this one will represent 001 in binary, then this 2 will represent 010 in the binary number system, this one is 001 again, and this 7 is 111. So this number is the same as this number, which is now in binary. Okay, so this is now in binary, and then we have to convert it into the base 16 or hexadecimal, and so we can combine four digit or four binary bits together to make it as in hexadecimal number. So this 4 will represent, this 41 will represent F here, because this is actually the decimal equivalent is 15 of these four digit 111, and the 15 is represented by F in the hexadecimal number system. So this will represent F. Now again I am combining these four bits together. So this is basically 8, 1000 is 8. So in hexadecimal it will also same as 8. Okay, now this 0 decimal, and in hexadecimal also this will be same 2. Okay, so 28F, this will be the right hexadecimal equivalent of this octal equivalent number. So 028F, this is the answer here.
Question number 58 says, which of the following is not a life cycle model? Okay, so we know that Spiral is a software development life cycle model, prototyping is a software development life cycle model, waterfall is definitely a life cycle model, capability maturity model. This is not a development cycle, this is not a development model, but this is a project management model. Okay, using CMM model, as we discussed in the last question, CMM model is used for software project management. Management means in this we manage the stages of the software development. We plan how this stage will be carried out, what can be the improvements in this stage. So like this, in every stage we apply capability maturity model to refine the software development process. So this is not a life cycle model, this is a software project management model. So D is the answer for this question. A, C, B are the software development processes.
In this question, we have to identify the best arithmetic expression has balanced parenthesis is A. So we have these options, Q, stack, tree, list. So we have to check the whether an arithmetic expression has balanced parenthesis or not. So let's suppose this is our arithmetic expression. For example, this A plus B bracket and this open parenthesis, left parenthesis, this into C plus D, and this is complete the right parenthesis, okay, for this left parenthesis. So we have to check the balance these parentheses, means open parenthesis and close parenthesis, left or right. Okay, so we can take one stack here for matching these pairs for left parenthesis and right parenthesis, and we are scanning the input here from left to right. Whenever we encounter one left parenthesis, we'll push this left parenthesis into the stack. Okay, so whenever we encounter, since we are encountering here this left parenthesis or open bracket, so I am pushing this left parenthesis into the stack. Now I am incrementing this pointer. Now it will point to this again, this left parenthesis is scanning, so I can again push this left parenthesis into the stack. So these two will be here. Now A plus B will not do anything with respect to the arithmetic variables or arithmetic terms. Okay, so A plus B, I'm not doing anything. Now we'll scan this right parenthesis, and whenever we scan one right parenthesis, we'll match or we'll compare this right parenthesis with this left parenthesis. So we will have to pop this left parenthesis corresponding to this right parenthesis. So whenever we encounter the right parenthesis, we'll pop one left parenthesis from the stack. So now stack will have only this left parenthesis. Now again this star will scan it. So we'll not do anything with respect to this star, since it is operator. Now again this left parenthesis is coming, so I'll push this left parenthesis into the stack, and this C plus D, I'll not do anything regarding this. Now we are scanned here this right parenthesis. Okay, so I'll pop this left parenthesis with respect to this right parenthesis. So we are again popping this. So now in the stack only this left parenthesis will be left. Okay, and now this is the last symbol of the string, which is last symbol of the arithmetic expression, which is also the right parenthesis or closed parenthesis. So I'll compare this right with this left. So I'll again pop this left parenthesis from the stack. So now our stack is empty. Okay, so we can match or we can balance, we can check the balanced parenthesis problem with the use of this stack. So stack data structure is useful to check whether an arithmetic expression has balanced parenthesis or not. So this is our right answer, B, stack.
Question number 60 says the cyclomatic complexity of each of the module X and Y shown is 10. Okay, so we have cyclomatic complexity of X 10 and Y 10. What is the cyclomatic complexity if the sequential integration shown on the right hand side? So what we have two modules X and Y, and we have cyclomatic complexity of X and Y, that is 10 and 10. Now what I am doing is I am integrating these two modules into one sequential module. Okay, I am integrating them sequentially one after another. So first thing we know that cyclomatic complexity equals to, and cyclomatic complexity in graph theory same as number of regions in a graph. So cyclomatic complexity equals to number of decision points plus 1. Okay, this is the number of decision points plus 1. Cyclomatic complexity is number of decisions points plus 1. So as we know that first to count this in this stage we will have some decision points. For example, this is inside the X. Okay, this is the model inside the X. We have this model. In this, how many regions we have? We have two regions, two bounded regions and one upper region. So this is the number of decision points. Okay, we have two decision points in this, and the cyclomatic complexity is 3. So we can say cyclomatic complexity equals to number of decision points plus 1. So if I calculate number of decision points in this and number of decision points in this and I add them, then I will have number of decision points in this complete graph, and then I can add 1 to find the cyclomatic complexity. So in X I have cyclomatic complexity, there is 10. 10 equals to number of decision points plus 1. So number of decision points in X are 9, and like this number of decision points in X in Y is equals to 9. So what will be the time complex, what will be the cyclomatic complexity for complete model? It will be number of decision points of this graph plus 1, and when I add number of decision point of this and this, that is 9 plus 9. Number of decision points are 18 in this this graph which I have obtained by integrating two modules. And now if I want to find cyclomatic complexity, I can say number of decision points plus 1, that is 18 plus 1. So I can say there are 18 bounded regions or decision points in this complete, in this graph, in this module, the module which is obtained by integrating these two modules, and plus 1, that is unbounded regions, I will have 19 regions. So cyclomatic complexity is nothing but total number of regions in a graph. So according to this, 19, and option B is correct for this question. 61 says, in software maintenance, tackling the changes in the hardware or software environment where the software works is A, corrective maintenance, B, perfective maintenance, adaptive maintenance, or preventive maintenance. So in software maintenance, that is last stage of software development life cycle, we have four kind of maintenance, that is corrective, perfective, and adaptive and preventive. Corrective maintenance is carried out when there are some errors in the software. Errors means now user is using the software and he finds that there are some errors in the software. Then we go to the user side and try to correct those errors. So this is corrective maintenance, when we are correcting the errors at the user side. Perfective maintenance means now we are enhancing the software. Okay, we are making the software more better. We are doing the updations in the software. Software does not have any error, but we are adding some functionalities. We are making the software more adaptive, more perfective. So this is perfective maintenance when we are adding some functionalities to the software. This is perfective maintenance. Adaptive maintenance means we are making the software platform independent. Okay, if I want to move my software from one platform to another, I am using hardware configuration and or I am using another operating system. Okay, I am changing the operating system of my computer. So I want my software to adopt according to the operating system and the new machine. So this is adaptive maintenance. These preventive maintenance. Preventive maintenance means for correcting any error, you correct errors either all or none. In preventive maintenance, we have some errors which cannot be corrected. So what we do is we apply preventive process. In preventive errors, we try to remove either all errors or none. So according to this question, if we are changing the hardware or software environment, then what we need to do is we need to do adaptive maintenance. That's what we are trying to make our software portable or hardware independent and software or operating system independent. So answer for 61 question is adaptive maintenance.
In this question, we have to find what will be the output of following C code. So we have given this C code and we have to identify what is the output of the C code. In this code, CPU will start the execution from this main function. So in this main function, there is one variable I which is declared. So I and variable, this I variable is initialized here with 0. Okay, so I am putting the value 0 in the I. Now we can see that we are again declaring one variable I which is inside this bracket or this this block of code. So this is closed block of code. So this I variable which are now declaring here, it is local to this code. Okay, so I and the value of I is 10 here, and this I will remain only for this line, for this block of code. It will not accessible outside this block. Okay, so visibility of I, this I is not here, it is not visible here since this is local to this complete block, for block or for loop. Okay, so I am declaring one variable I and value of this I will be initialized by 10. Now printf percentage di, so in this block, in this local block, local value will be printed. So I, local value of I is 10 here, so this 10 will be printed first. Okay, now I++, so this incrementation is done on the local I only, so I will increment to the 11. Okay, so now first iteration of this for loop is completed. Now I which is associated with this main function outside the for loop. Okay, so value of I is incremented by 1, so 0 and 1 because of this for loop. Okay, so I++ means value of I is incremented by 1 after the first iteration of this for loop. Now this I is having 1 value and this I is having 11. Okay, now again for I equals to, since this 1 is less than 5, again one I is declaring here inside the for loop. So one I again it will declare, and in this I value will come 10 here. Okay, so value is 10 here. Now again printf percentage di, so this I is now local to this for loop, so this value will be printed next. So again 10 will be printed here, and I++ means 11 will be updated here, and now this loop is completed, this iteration is completed. So again it will go to I++, which will increment this I's value by 1, which is 2 now, and since 2 is less than 5, again the memory of I will be allocated, and I is having the value 10, and this I will be local to this for loop or this iteration. Okay, so this I is for only this for loop. So now again printf percentage di, so again the 10 will be printed, and I++, it means it will update the value of I to 11. So same thing happens for 5 times, so every time only 10 is printed, so these the answer will be 5 times 10 will be printed. Okay, by this code. So answer is B here. In this question, what does the following program do when the input is unsigned 16-bit integer? Okay, so we have given this is integer size is 16-bit or 2 bytes. Okay, so here this is unsigned integer num, which is num declared here. I is also one variable which is declared here. Okay, I. Now scanf percentage %u ampersand %num. So we can take any value here. I am taking the value num as 10 for simplicity. Okay, so now for I equals to 0, I less than 16, I plus plus. So this for loop will run 16 times. Okay, now it will print printf percentage %d and this whole operation. Okay, so now here in this expression there are three operators involved, which is first this parenthesis operator. So the highest precedence will be to the this parenthesis operator. So parenthesis operator will be performed first. Then in the parenthesis there are two operators, left shift and this one. Okay, this first is left shift, this is left shift operator, this is also left shift operator, but this is the bitwise AND operator. And we know that the precedence of left shift is higher than the bitwise AND. So first this left shift will be performed, and then this left shift will perform, and then the bitwise AND operator will be performed. Okay, and after this this complete parenthesis is performed, expression of this is performed, then this ternary operator, this is actually ternary operator, then this ternary operator will be executed next. Okay, so we are assuming here num equals to 10. So for I equals to 0, okay, int value of I is 0. Now printf, first this parenthesis will be executed, in this parenthesis num left shift I. Okay, so num means this 10, it is if we can write the binary equivalent of this number, then it will be very helpful in this code. So we are writing the binary equivalent here 0000 0000, this one 0000 and 1010. This is the binary equivalent of this num. Okay, now num left shifted by I and I is 0, so basically num is left shifted by 0 time. Okay, so it is left shifted by 0 time, it means it will remain same in the first iteration. So num is this, and now AND means bitwise AND, so we have to perform this AND operation with 1 is left shifted by 15 times. So 1 is like this 0000 15 times and 1. Okay, this is 16th position is 1. So now 1 is left shifted by 15 times. Okay, 15 position 1 is left shifted. So if we are doing left shifting here 15 position, then this 1 will come into this 16th position. Okay, so here 1 will occur and all the remaining bits are 0. So this is 1 and then so on 0000, this 0000, this will be our final operation. So if we are doing the bitwise AND operation here, so this 1 and 0 bitwise AND operation means we have to perform the AND operation bitwisely. So 0 and 1 it will give 0, 0 and 0 it will give 0. Whenever the two both the bits will be 1, then only we will get the 1 as output. Okay, so here all bits are 0 and this 0 and 1 is again 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0 and 0. So this will completely give 0. Okay, so this is 0. Since here this is 0, so this condition is false actually. In the ternary operator, this is if the ternary operator, if this value or this expression is false, then it will take value after this colon operation. Okay, so colon operator, okay, so it will take value as 0. So in the first iteration it will print 0. In the second iteration again this will happen. Now if I value of I is 1, so we'll left shift this number by 1 time. Okay, so 1 time means this 1. So after this left shifting, the resulting number will be like this. Okay, 0000, we are doing left shift by 1 position, so it will 101 will be here. Okay, 101 will be here in the left shift. So after applying the left shift, this is basically like this 1010. It will give value as 10100. It is left shifted and 101, 1010. Now here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now here 11 times 0 will be present here. Okay, so 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. This is 8 times and then 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, so this is the left shift by one time. Now again we are doing the ampersand or AND operator, bitwise AND operator, with one left shifted by 15. So one left shifted by 15, it will always give this value 1, 1 is in the 16th position, 16th bit position, and remaining all bit will be 0. Okay, so these all will be 0 now. So again this will give 0, 0, 0, 0, all bits are 0. Okay, in one iteration, if in any iteration this one will come into this position, this position, okay, so whenever this one will come into this first position, then only it will give one. Okay, so it will around, I think it will all these zero will be printed, then after this one will be come here in the first position, and then this one and this one AND will give one, so it will print one, because this number is, this number is not zero at that time. Okay, that time this number will not zero. So if this number is not zero, then this value of the ternary operator will be printed as one. Okay, so whenever these one will be come here, after all these zero, this one will come here, and then only it will print the one. Okay, it will print here one. So basically after all these zero, this one will print, and then the after this one, this zero again prints, then this one, and then this zero. Okay, so it is actually printing the same number in the binary equivalent of number. Okay, so it prints binary equivalent of the same number 10. So this will print this value completely. You can apply this operation so 16 times. Okay, or you can iterate this for loop, and you will get the same result here as the number which is present in its binary equivalent form. So this is the printed value, this will be printed by this code, this 000 and 1010. So it prints binary equivalent of number. In this question we have given one code, C code, and we have to identify what is the output of this program. Okay, so basically this is int temp equals to 20. It is above the main function, so it is not in the main functions body or this functions body. So this variable is called the global variable, and it will be accessible for all the functions which are present in this program. Okay, so this is global variable temp, and it is initialized as 20. Now the CPU will start the execution from the main function. First it will print f percentage d temp, since this tmp, okay, it has to print this tmp, and this tmp variable is not present in the local body of main function. So it will go in to the top of this and see that there is one global variable tmp. So it will print 20 first. Okay, now this 20 is printed first. Now it will call the function func. This is the function calling. So this function is calling now. So in this function, this there is one variable, static variable, that is static int temp equals to 10. Okay, so this variable is also declaring one temp variable which is having the same name of this global variable tmp. So this tmp is again allocated memory, and since this is static function, this is static variable, so this is initialized only one time. Okay, so this the 10 will be initialized into this tmp, which is a static, but this variable tmp is local to the function, this func function. Okay, so it will not be accessible outside this function. Outside this function it will be not accessible, because it will be declared inside the this function's body, inside this function's body. So this is declared now. It is initialized with 10, and then the next instruction, which is printf percentage d tmp. So this tmp here, it is printing again tmp, and this tmp will be this local this function's local variable tmp. Okay, so it will be printed now. This is 10, so 20 10 is printed, and again printf when this function function's calling is ended. So again the control will go to the main functions. Now printf percentage d temp. Okay, so tmp, again this TMP will be printed, which is global variable, because this main function is not having the variable TMP, and this TMP, which is static and which is local to this function FUNC, it is not accessible outside this function's body. Okay, so now this TMP 20 is again printed. So 20, 10, 20, this is the final answer.
Question number 65 says, which product matrix gives the measure of the average length of words and sentences in document? So when we measure the performance of a software, we measure many things like line of codes, effort taken in the software, cost of the software, all these things we identify in the software measurement. Okay, software measurement process. So first, your first matrix is length of identifier. In length of identifier, what we do is we see the length of the identifiers. If the length of identifier is long, then this means that identifier will have a useful meaning. Let's say you are saying int a equals to point. So what is the name of identifier a? If I keep the name like this, int x axis, this means this is meaningful. I know that this is the value of x axis. So from identifier, if I am giving useful meanings, then the length of identifier will definitely increase. So more the length of identifier, more meaningful it is. So in SRS document or any other document, if I'm finding length of identifiers are long, then this means identifiers are useful name. Second is line of code. In line of code, what we do is we try to find out how many lines of code we have in our program, and according to that we find the complexity of the program. Third is cyclomatic complexity. So these are the software matrices. This is a measure of control complexity of a program. This control complexity may be reduced, may be related to program understandability, which means if we have more decision points in our software, let's say we have if else, many if else in our software, then we can simply, this will increase the readability of the software. Okay, so we can ident the if else according to their inner and outer if else. So if cyclomatic complexity gives how many decision points do you have in your computer, in your program. So according to cyclomatic complexity is useful in increasing the understandability of the program. Okay, you can say from here we will jump to there. In structured programming, understandability is very important point, in which we implement the understandability through the decision points. Fog index is, for we have fog index, and fog index is used to find the average length of words and sentences in the document. We have SRS document, let's say any document in any stage. If the length of sentences and length of words are much, then this means the document is some complex point. So to increase the readability of a document, there should be a less length of sentences and words. So this is asking about the length of words and sentences in document, and fog of index gives this metric. Okay, this is the matrix with which gives length of words and sentences in the document. So for question number 65, answer is B.
In this question we have given, consider the disk system with 100 cylinders. Okay, so in this disk 100 cylinders are present, and the request to access the cylinders, okay, occurs in the following sequence. So this is the cylinder number 4, 37, 10. This is the request which is following the order. So this is actually the order of the request to access the cylinders. Now assuming the head is currently at cylinder number 50, what is the time taken to satisfy all requirements if it takes 1 millisecond to move from one cylinder to adjacent? So this line means if currently the head is at, let's suppose currently head is at position 50 and it has to go 48, okay, so it has to move to 48, cylinder number 48. So this will take 2 milliseconds, because Because here in this question it is given, it takes 1 millisecond to move from one cylinder to adjacent one. Okay, so adjacent one, and shortest seek time first algorithm is used here. So here shortest seek time first, SSTF. Okay, shortest seek time first algorithm is used. So what is the shortest seek time first in this? Let's suppose we have this is the scale in which we can allocate the number of the cylinder number. Okay, so I'm writing here in the increasing order of the cylinder number. So 2, 4, then 6, then 7, then 10, then 15, then 19. These are the cylinder requests. Okay, 19, then 20, then 37, and then there is 73. Okay. And this is 50. Okay, and it is saying that in the question our head is currently at cylinder number 50, so our head is here at starting. Now it is using the shortest seek time first, so it will calculate the distance both in, from both side. Okay, for example this 50, it can go to 73 or it can go to 37. So first it will calculate the distance. Since 37 and 50, the distance here is 13, and here the difference is 23. Okay, 50 and 73. So it will go to the to this direction first. Means 37, the request number 37, this will be accessed first. So now the cylinder will be in position 37. Okay, now 37. So difference will be 20 and 37 is 17, and this difference is obviously greater. So it will go to this direction, then 20 and 9 this direction, and similarly then 15 will be accessed, then 10 will be accessed, then cylinder number 7 will be accessed, and then 6, and then 4, and then 2 finally. And finally when this 2 is accessed, okay, cylinder number 2 is accessed, now only one request is left, which is the having the cylinder number 73. So it will go from 2 to 73 to fulfill this request. Okay, 73. So now we have to calculate what is the total number of movements this head has to go, or it has to go on the total number of distance cover to find the this. Okay, this total head movement. Okay, so now we have to calculate this plus this. So from 50, first it will go to 2. Okay, so 50 minus 2, which is 48. So it makes the movement 48 from here to here. Now from 2 to 73, it has to go. Okay, so from 2 minus 73, it has to go 71 movements. It has to undergo 71 movements. So total will be 8 plus 1, 9. 7 plus 4, 119. So this 119 millisecond, it is the answer. Okay, so this is final answer. In this question, a B-tree used as an index for a large database table has 4 levels including the root node. Okay, so it has 4 levels. So I have created one B-tree. This is B-tree. This is level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. This is the root of the B-tree. Okay, so if a new key is inserted in this index, then the maximum number of nodes that could be newly created in the process are. So I have created this B-tree, and you can assume these are the data variables which I take these variables randomly. So it is not necessary that these will be the elements right for the B-tree. Okay, so it can be any random element here. But this is the structure of the B-tree. Okay, now if a new key is inserted in this index, then the maximum number of nodes that could be newly created in the process are. So let's suppose we are inserting one element here, E. Let's suppose one element E. So A, B, C and E, or E, okay, or D. We are inserting this element D. Since this is the fully located node, it means order is 4. Let's suppose order is 4. Okay, if order is 4, so it can accommodate 3 key values. So this is the 3 key values A, B and C. Now again one value is coming in this node only. In this particular node, one key we have to insert. This is the structure of B-tree. So this node will overflow now. Okay, so here data is overflowed. So this node will become or this node will partition into two node. Okay, so this D, okay, so now this node will break and there will be two separate node here and here, these two separate nodes, and this value, one of these value will go up onto the level, okay, in upper level. So one value, let's suppose C is coming here, so now C and this, again this XYZ C, so if we have to insert this value here, so again this node will be breaked, this node will be broken, and one more new node will become here, okay, and because it is also fully filled node, it is actually filled node fully, so we have to break this node, so it will again break one node, and now this value again XYZ C, let's suppose this value Y is going up in the order, so now again here overflow is occurring, so again this node will be broken into another node, and the value of, let's suppose this Q will be going up here, okay, up in the order, so now again this node is fully filled, so PQ, this M, N, O and Q, okay, so again here overflow occurred, so one more node will be created here, and one more node which will be new root will be created here, and this will point to this and this, and this will point to this, okay, so this is the structure. Like, so what are the new nodes we have to created here, we should have to create it, so this is the first, we have created this one, this one, this one, this one and this one, so there are totally 1, 2, 3, 5 nodes, okay, so we can generalize this, if there are 4 levels including the node which is given in the question, 4 levels including the root node, if a new key is inserted in this, then the maximum number of nodes that could be newly created in the process are actually 5, okay, so whenever there are n levels, okay, and if we have to insert any key, so there could be maximum n plus 1 node will have to create it, okay, in B tree or in B plus tree, so this is the answer, n plus 1, if there are n levels then n plus 1, 4 level, so 5 is the answer. In this question, a critical region is, so basically critical region is a piece of code which only one process executes at a time. This statement is wrong in the option A. Critical region is a region prone to deadlock, this is also false, is a piece of code which only a finite number of processes execute. This is also wrong. Is found only in Windows NT program. No, this is wrong. Actually, this statement is true, which I stated as false. This statement is actually true. A critical region is a piece of code which only one process executes at a time. Okay, so in the critical, let's suppose this is the process P1, and there are two sections. This is the entry section, or this is some code sections here. Now this is critical section CS, and this is some exit section. Okay, now what it means, the critical section, so if there are many processes in the system P1, P2, P3 like this, okay, and they are sharing some variable or they have some shared variables in the code, okay, so the shared variables code, okay, so the part of the code in which the code is trying to access the shared variables or shared resources, that part of the code is called the critical section. Okay, and critical section, since this is in the critical section, there might be the shared variables or shared resources can be present. So this critical section will be executed in a mutually exclusive manner. It means it is a piece of code which only one process executes at a time. Okay, so when P1 is executing its critical section, then no process P2, P3 and no any other process can allow to execute its critical section. So this is called the critical region or critical section. So basically critical region is a piece of code which only one process executes at a time. This is the right answer, A. In this question, we have given one expression which is infix expression, and we have to choose the equivalent prefix expression for this following expression. Okay, so since this is the infix expression, so we can calculate this like this. First, this parenthesis a plus b minus c, this whole parenthesis will be solved. Then this is multiplication operator star. Then this whole parenthesis d minus c divided by f plus g minus h will be solved. Okay, so we can make the expression tree for this expression. Okay, so what is the expression tree? In the expression tree, the root will be operand, root will be operator, and the child of that particular node will be operand for that operator. For example, if we have to write a plus b in the expression tree, this will be plus a and b, like this. Okay, or like this. Okay, so for this I am doing this expression tree. I am trying to make this expression tree. So star is the first operator, because in the star this is the left operand and this is the right operand. Okay, so in the star this is left and this is right. Now in the left operand there are two operator involved, which is plus and minus, and since here it is one parenthesis, so b minus c should be executed first. Okay, because precedence of this parenthesis is higher than this plus. Okay, so now for this I am doing this thing. It is actually a plus, because this plus operator is having the operand a and b minus c. Okay, so a and b minus c. For b minus c I am doing here, this is minus b minus c. So this is the final. And in the right hand of this star, or this operator star, there is d minus e divided by f plus g minus h. Okay, so divide is our main operator here, and operand of this is d minus e and f plus g minus h. So d minus e, it means minus here d minus e. Okay, so this is the operand for this operator minus. Now in this operand, the right hand side operand of this divide, this is f plus g minus h, and since plus and minus both have the equal precedence, but if in the expression both are coming. Okay, so we have to evaluate this from left to right, whichever operator will come the leftmost will be executed first. So in this, plus will be executed first. So since plus is executed first, so minus will be one operator here, this, and the left hand side of the minus operator will be f plus g, and the right hand side is h. So left hand side is plus f plus g actually, so f g, and right hand side will be h. Okay, so this is the expression tree for this given expression. Now if you want to verify this expression tree is right or not, so we can do in order traversal of this expression tree, and it will give the same expression as this. Okay, so if we are doing in order, so star in the in order traversal, we'll go from starting from the root, we'll go from top to down and left to right. It means we go from here. Okay, and whenever we have visited the second time in any node, if we are visiting the second time, we'll print that node or we'll operate that node. Okay, so this, now this a is first time, this plus is first time, a is now first time. Now here null, so I am go here, it is null, coming here it is now second time. So first a have to print, now right is null, third time no print, this plus is now printed because it is the second time visiting. We are visiting the plus second time, so a plus. Now this minus is first time, b is first time, now this b is second time. So I am doing here b, minus is second time, so printing minus here, c is first time, no printing, then c is second time here. Okay, so printing c here, and then minus third time, plus third time, star is now second time, so I am printing star here. Okay, so this complete will be one operand, and similarly if I'll do in order traversal of this right subtree of this star, okay, right subtree of the star operator, it will give this me complete expression. So now this corresponds to right expression tree with this expression. Now I have to find the prefix form of this expression. So in the prefix form, we'll go again same from root, we'll start from root and we'll go from top to down and left to right, okay? And whenever we are visiting the node first time, we have to print that node. Why? Because we are printing here prefix expression. So star is now star, this is root, star is visiting first time, so we'll print this star. So star is printed. Then we'll go in this plus. Plus is visiting the first time, so we'll print first this plus again. Now A is visiting first time, so we'll print A again. Now come here, then come here. This plus, no visiting. Now this minus is visiting the first time, so we'll print minus here. Again this B will be printing first time. Okay, so B will visiting with the first time, so we'll have to print the B also. So here we'll print B. Then again we'll go this minus is now second time. This C is now first time, so BC. Now again this is the second time, third time. This is third time, this is second time. Now this divide operator is the first time, so I'm printing here divide operator. Now this minus is first time, so I'm printing here minus. This D is visiting the first time, so I'll printing the D here. Again this D will go here second time, third time. This minus is second time. Now this E is first time, so I'm printing E here. Again this E is second time, third time, and then divide operator the second time, so I'm not printing because we have to print only when we are visiting the first time. So divide is not printed. This minus is visiting the first time, so I'll print here minus. Now this plus visiting first time, so I'm printing here. This F, this is actually F, so I'm printing this F also because we are visiting F first time. And then this second time, third time, I'm not printing. Now again plus is print, plus is the visiting second time, so I'm not printing this plus operator. Now G is printing the first time, so I'm visiting the first time, so I'm printing this G here. And then again this G second time, third time, minus is second time. This H is now first time, so I have to print H because we are visiting it second time, first time. And now H second time, third time, and all these operators are now third time, and we reached to the root. Okay, so this is the prefix expression for this expression tree. So we can match the answer: star plus A minus BC, divide operator minus DE minus plus FGH. So this is the right answer, A. In this question, at a particular time the value of counting semaphore is 10. So there is one counting semaphore and the value of that semaphore is 10 in the starting or at a particular time. It will become 7 after. Okay, so we have given some operations and we have to tell the final value. It means we have also given that the final value of this counting semaphore will become 7. So we have to identify which of the following operations we have to perform to get this final value as 7 of this counting semaphore C. So now this counting semaphore is starting value is 10. Okay, so we know first the operations like V and P. Okay, so this P operation is actually the wait operation, or we can say it a down operation. In this operation we have to decrement the current value of the counting semaphore. So we have to decrement the value by 1. See, okay, so decrement the value, current value, by 1, it will correspond to P operation. And V operations means it is also called up operation or signal operation. In this we have to increment, okay, so plus. In this we have to increment the value by 1, the current value of counting semaphore. Okay, so now the current value is 10. So if we are performing 3 V operations, mean the then the value of the counting semaphore will be 13. But in the question it is given it will become 7. Okay, so it is not the right choice. Now 3P. Okay, so thus 10 minus 3, which will become 7. So now it is right, yeah, because in question it is saying it will become 7. So after 3P operation it is going 7. Okay, it's going to have the value as 7. Now in the third option, 5V operations and 2P operations. So if we do 5V operations means 10 plus 5, and 2P operations means minus 2. Okay, so 10 plus 5, 15 minus 2, which is 13. So it is also not right option. And the last one is 2V operations and 5P operations. So 2V means 10 plus 2. Okay, so 10 plus 2, it means 12, minus 5p, so minus 5, which is also giving the value as 7. So it will become 7 after 2v operations and 5p operations also. So there are two options correct. Okay, this 3p operation is also right, and this d operation, this d option is also right.
Question number 72 says the Linux command mknode myfifo b416, what it will do? So we have a command make node in Unix, and the format of this command is make node, then device name, then we have device type, then major number and minor number. MakeNode is used to create a node for a device or a file. In Unix, everything is a file, whether it is a device or it is a file or it is a folder, everything is a file in Unix. So to add new device, what we do is we use the command make node, and then we use device name. Okay, let's say device name is myfifo. Then device type can be b, that is block device. Block devices are those in which data transfer is done in the form of devices, in the form of blocks, like hard disk or your CD/DVD-ROM or tape. These are the block devices. Then we have character devices. If we have character device, then we will use C. Character devices are like these printers or other devices which transfer the data in form of characters. Okay, like this we have different type of devices. So if we use B, I am saying that make a node with this name of my file, myfifo. This is a device which is block device, and the measured number is 4 and maximum number is 16. So this represent whether it is a root or a simple user or what it is. So according to options, will create a character device, no, this will create a block device. So this is definitely will not an option. These two are the eliminated. Now we have B and C. Will create a named pyfifo if the user is root. Okay, this is false because this is not specifying what type of device this is. This is not creating a pipe, this is creating a device, a block device. So C says will create a block device if the user is root. This is true. It will create a block device if the user is root. Okay, so C option for this question is correct.
In this question, which of the following statement is true? Okay, so hard real-time operating system has less jitter than soft real-time operating system. So they are saying about the real-time operating system. Okay, all the statements are related with the real-time operating system. So we should know about what is real-time operating system. So basically the real-time operating system means the system which this system, real-time operating system, will perform some task within a specified time period, or there will be some deadline, and this operating system has to perform all the operations within that specified time period or within that the deadline. Okay, so this is called the real-time operating system. And this RTOS, real-time operating system, has two variants. Okay, so one is the hard real-time operating system, hard RTOS, and the second one is the soft. Okay, so the second one is soft RTOS, soft real-time operating system. Okay, so a key characteristic of a real-time operating system is the level of its consistency concerning the amount of time it takes to accept and complete an application's task. Okay, so we can measure the level of the consistency or the performance of that real-time operating system with the help of one variable. Okay, and this variability or this small characteristic is called the jitter. Okay, so with the help of this jitter thing, okay, this is called jitter, and with the help of this jitter variable, we can track or we can perform the measure or keep track the measure of the this performance of real-time operating system. So hard real-time operating system means it has to perform within the specified time period or within the specified deadline. Definitely it has to perform, means it has to perform deterministically, okay? But the soft real-time operating system means it will perform generally, okay? Generally it will perform, but it is not guaranteed that it will perform definitely within the deadline or within the specified time period, okay? So this is called the soft real-time operating system. So basically the hard real-time operating systems are having the less jitter, means this variability or this measure should be less, okay, for hard real-time operating system. So hard real-time operating system should have less jitter, but the soft real-time operating system will have more jitter, okay? So they are flexible. Basically soft real-time operating system are generally perform the specified time in a deadline, but not always. But this hard real-time operating system will have to perform, okay, in the deadline, in the specified time period. So they has the less jitter, and this soft real-time operating system has the higher jitter. Okay, so the statement is hard real-time operating system has less jitter than soft real-time operating system. This statement is true. In this question, if L and P, we have given L and P are two recursively enumerable languages. So L and P are two recursively enumerable language. Both of these are recursively enumerable language, and they are not closed under. Okay, so clean star L star of L. So if one recursive enumerable language L, then L star or clean closer of this recursively enumerable language will also a recursively enumerable language. We know that recursively enumerable languages are closed. They are closed under union, intersection, and clean star. Okay, clean star. So intersection of L and P. So L is one recursively enumerable and P is also one recursively enumerable language. So intersection of these two will also be a recursively enumerable. So this is also closed. The third one is union of these two recursively enumerable languages also recursively enumerable. So they are closed under this operation also. But set difference, they are not closed under set difference operation. So our right answer is D here. Why they are not closed under set difference? Because if, let's suppose this is L and I am subtracting this set P, okay, P which is also one regular recursively enumerable language. So this L minus P, it is equivalent to L intersection of P complement. Why P complement? Suppose if you have to perform the set difference set difference you have to perform, and this is one set A, this is one set B. So A minus B is equals to this, basically. Yeah. So A minus B is this shaded portion. If I do A intersection B complement, okay, A intersection B complement means A intersection B complement, okay. So this will also give the same result as this shaded region, okay. So this will also give this shaded region, which is A intersection B complement equivalent to A minus B. So set difference is equivalent to this. Now we know that this P complement, which is complement of the recursively enumerable language, is not recursively enumerable, because recursively enumerable languages are not closed under complement. So since this will be not the recursively enumerable language, now we cannot say that this L intersection not recursively enumerable, not RE, okay. We cannot say one recursively enumerable and one is not recursively enumerable. So it will not be the recursively enumerable language, okay. So set difference operation is not closed under the recursively enumerable, not closed under the set difference in the recursively enumerable language, okay. So answer is set difference here.
Question number 78 says, in the context of modular software design, which one of the following combination is desirable? So when we design a software, we design the software into modules. Okay, we have modules in a software, and we have two properties of modules, that is cohesion and coupling. Cohesion means how closely the elements inside a module are related to each other. Coupling means how strongly the modules are connected to each other. So if there is high coupling means they are connected to each other very strongly. They are dependent on each other. High coupling means they are dependent on each other highly. Low coupling means they are not, they are related to each other very in the low form. So if I want to modify one module, then there should be a low coupling. If there is a high coupling, then if I modify one module, this will affect another module badly. So I cannot modify the modules independently if I have high coupling. So there should be low coupling for a good modular design. Low coupling, that means they should be independent of each other. Okay, this is means loosely coupled. Loosely coupled means not too much dependent on each other. If highly coupled, that means they are dependent on each other highly. And cohesion means how closely modules, the elements inside a module are related to each other. So there should be high cohesion for a good modular design. Okay, the elements inside a module should be related to each other highly. Okay, there should be a relation between lines of a module. So for a modular design, I will prefer low coupling and high cohesion. So according to this, B option is correct for this question, that is high cohesion and low coupling. This is desirable for good modular design. So option B is correct for this question.
In this question, the time complexity of computing the transitive closure of a binary relation on a set of elements is known to be A. Okay, so for knowing the transitive closure of a binary relation, we can perform the Floyd-Warshall all-pair shortest path algorithm to find this transitive closure. For that, first we have to convert this binary relation. Okay, so this binary relation, we have to convert it first into matrix. Okay, now this matrix, we can apply the Floyd-Warshall all pair shortest path algorithm. Just Floyd-Warshall all pair shortest path algorithm into this matrix to find the transitive closure. Okay, so we'll find the transitive closure with the help of this Floyd-Warshall algorithm. And since we know the Floyd-Warshall complexity of Floyd-Warshall algorithm is order of n cube, if there are n number of vertices in the graph, or n if the matrix is of n cross n size, then it will give, the time complexity will be order of n cube. Okay, so the transitive closure of a binary relation on a set of n elements is known to be a order of n cube. This is the perfect algorithm. This Floyd-Warshall algorithm will solve this problem, and the time complexity will be order of n cube.